unmute, and now we should be coming through live. Yay, nay.
My site still says waiting. Hold on.
Yeah, maybe check the video. I did have to refresh it. That may have refreshed the room.
Yeah, it did.
Test, hello?
Yay, nay.
All right, sweet. So yeah, we are good. A little bit of technical nonsense, as always, seems like. I mean, I guess it fits, right? Because North Central Positronics is not necessarily, you know, an upstanding company that would try to keep things running smoothly, you know? It seems like they're... Although,
they like it running smoothly when it fits their purpose.
Yeah, I'll say, though, I think I would take them and Sombra and the Crimson King over Comcast.
That's a tough choice, but I think I'd agree with you.
Okay. Let's see. Let me get the stuff ready here, and we'll get... I guess we can just jump right into it and get started with the intros here. This is kind of a weird one, actually, because, like, I was trying to think to myself, with Unfound Doors, I usually wouldn't do the normal Dark Tower intro, but
yeah.
I feel like now that it's, like, a kind of a different, like, I don't know, we fused it a little bit more now, like, you know, Unfound Door, this is the first one that you would be involved in, Unfound Door-wise, so, yeah, I think we'll hit the normal intro, and then, you know, jump into...
Yeah, because it's the Dark Tower palaver, you know. Exploring this level of the tower.
Yeah,
you know?
Yeah. I don't know. I guess I've only done a couple of the Unfound Doors, and I wasn't necessarily sure the best way to go about it in terms of intros. So let's go ahead and hit our intro and get rolling.
The Dark Tower by Stephen King. The man in black fled across the desert, and the gunslinger followed.
Go then. There are other worlds than these. Death, but not for you, gunslinger.
It's time we had our own palaver, I think, and it's going to take a while.
And yet... dauntless, the slug horn to my lips I set and blew. Child Roland to the Dark Tower came.
We are Kartet, one from many. Let the palaver begin.
Hello and welcome to Dark Tower Palaver. This is our podcast covering normally the Dark Tower series, although this is going to be a unique episode for, I guess, especially both of us. But I'll start by saying my name is Tad.
And I'm Peter.
And we're here for the first Unfound Door that has both of us. And it's actually an interesting one because we're also jumping back through the same door that I've once gone through before in this series to talk about The Shining. Although when I did it before, I was just strictly talking about the novel, and it was just me. This time, we actually teased this right around New Year's, I believe.
Mm-hmm.
We were talking about doing a big kind of jumbo episode on The Shining and consuming all of the aspects of it and then kind of talking about it. Of course, just The Shining. We're not talking about Dr. Sleep, although, God, I've been itching to watch. Because I still haven't watched the director's cut. I mentioned that on the last episode. And, dude, I wanted to. I think I actually might tonight. I think that's my plan tonight. Because after this, I'm going to curl up and watch the director's cut. As well as, dude, I've been wanting to start The Shining, or the stand, as is my normal tradition this time of the year. But I held off because I'm like, okay, I'm done. You know, I've watched everything. I've read everything. It's all fresh. I'm like, once I jump into the stand, though, I don't want it polluting my mind. So I've been, like, holding off, like, the last week. I've been, like, dying to, like, listen to the stand. In fact, I even started listening to the intro where King goes through the whole thing about,
you know,
read this when you're still in the store and your money's safely in your pocket. Like, this isn't a new book type thing. I even listened to that part, but then I stopped before I got to the actual book. So I'm
like torturing yourself, don't you?
Yeah. So I'm pretty excited to do this episode because I've definitely been all encompassing the Shining here for the past month or so for me, but certainly a lot since our last episode. So really excited to jump into Through the Unfound Door and into The Shining. You know, I actually was thinking about creating maybe an intro for this, and you know what foiled me? I couldn't figure, because like Dark Tower Palaver, like, you know, I figured I could even cobble that together like through the audiobooks.
Yeah,
but Unfound Door is probably going to be George Guidel because of where that falls in the series.
Yeah.
So it would have been different narrators for everything that like Dark Tower and Palaver, Let the Palaver Begin, all that kind of stuff. A lot of that stuff comes, I mean, our intro does have some of George.
Yeah.
But I was like thinking about maybe trying to just doctor up as shittily as I can do, just something that says like the Dark Tower Palaver presents The Unfound Door, and that I was like excited. I was like thinking like, okay, I just got to find those phrases and stuff. But then I'm like, I started to like pull it up and I'm like, oh wait,
yeah,
Frank and George, god damn it. So no,
I was just expecting something Shining, like Dick Halloran, just, you know, you got The Shining and then just that's it and just jump into it.
Well, I mean, I will go ahead and we can do at least this, because this
can we just leave that on repeat? Just have that going in the background while we're talking?
You know, on the screen as well, if you're watching on YouTube, you can see I've done, like, I actually thought about doing all the slides with the background of the Shining carpet, but I was just like, no, that might be a little bit overbearing. So I just kind of did it here for the title card. But we'll go ahead and hit our normal intro. I guess we would normally warn about spoilers. I guess we still can, because
definitely need to.
The way that we work, you know, we'll probably still end up spoiling the Dark Tower series. So if you haven't finished the seven previous books,
we also gotta let people know what we're spoiling. With
yeah,
the
no, that's true. But in terms of the Dark Tower,
is absolutely gonna get spoiled.
Yeah, we there's
it's
just
in our blood.
Yeah, there's no way for us to avoid it, it seems like. So if you haven't finished the seven primary books of the Dark Tower series, you may want to stick to our book club episodes. We stick in those where we're at or before, and never go ahead. So those are safe for someone that has not finished the series. Roundtables are certainly not safe. And if you want to find us, you can find us on Apple Podcasting, stream us on Stitcher or Spotify. You can find us on any podcasting service. If you want to subscribe, rate, and review us on any of those services, we would appreciate that. Apple's definitely one of the big ones. You can find our show notes at darktowerpalaver.com. On there, you'll find everything that we're talking about. You know, if I have pictures I'm showing Peter, or if I have articles that we're covering, they'll all be linked in the show notes, darktowerpalaver.com, as well as there's other things that pop up in there. If you're a new listener, you can always find the questions that we actually kind of cultivated those questions, interestingly enough. Like, we've changed them a tiny, tiny bit, but overall, those are the same questions we've been asking people pretty much since year one of the podcast. So those are long-standing questions as, like, kind of intro to yourself, like, introduce yourself as a Dark Tower fan. If you want to jump on the darktowerpalaver.com, find those questions. If you wanted to send us an email, if it was an introductory email, that is a good set of questions to answer. If you want to answer some of them or all of them, feel free. And if you want to email us, that's a number of ways you can contact us, and Peter can tell you about those.
Best way to reach us, like Tad said, is email. It's darktowerpalaver@gmail.com. We stream all of our shows. It's youtube.com/darktowerpalaver. Ted mentioned YouTube as well. It's where you can see the Shining slide right now if you're watching with us. Then we also have our social media. It's facebook.com/darktowerpalaver. And our Twitter is @darktowerpod. That's @darktowerpod. And then Instagram is darktowerpalaver. All one word, no spaces.
Yes, indeed. So yeah, there's a number of ways to reach out to us. Over the course of this week, I wanted to do more, but I did two polls, which, as we just go into the discussion, when I hit the spot that I can ask Peter those questions, I will, and as well as reveal to you the answers that we got. And yeah, so that's, we'll hit that. And I don't know. I'm definitely way more active on Twitter. The one thing I found too, that was annoying is I was going to put that same poll up on Facebook, but Facebook doesn't allow polls unless you're in a group.
Nope.
And I keep forgetting that we don't have a Dark Tower Palaver group. We just have our page that people are on. It might even be worth maybe looking into a group. I don't know. Let us know. I don't know how many, I know there's a lot of people that just don't use Facebook anymore. So let us know, like, if maybe having a Dark Tower Palaver group would be something you'd be interested in, because that would allow things like polls and stuff, and maybe it's a little bit easier than just being on our page and our wall. But I don't know, that's a thought I had when I was trying to put that poll up. It's like, damn it, we can't do polls. But I threw a few up and we'll talk about those for sure. But yeah, so The Shining, this is, I mean, I don't know, it's definitely one of King's more iconic works, and definitely one that, you know, it's interesting as we dove into this, you know, there's a lot of iterations, you know, like there's, you know, like, I mean, I guess like It, for instance, like over what, 30 years has had now two versions, and The Shining, I mean, I guess you have the book too, but, you know, I don't know, like it just feels like, and I guess with The Shining too, the movie so iconic that to have another adaptation in the 90s is, I don't know, unique, I guess, because that was a short turnaround too. That was only 17 years between The Shining movie and the miniseries, whereas like It was 27 years because it fit
the cycle
well within the cycle of Pennywise.
Yeah.
So, it's I don't know, but I'm really excited to talk about this because, yeah, like I said, I read it again. You know what I actually discovered too, when I dove into my Audible to figure out you know, whatever, I found that it was basically like in the bottom five of my thing. So I haven't listened to The Shining in a good while.
Yeah, same here.
I want to say that it may have been, honestly, right around the time of Dr. Sleep may have been the last time that I listened to it. Because it was not far off from Dr. Yeah. Sleep. So I'm like, I think I may have read this to prep for Dr. Sleep. And, well, no, I guess I would have for the Unfound Door episode, which would have been past Dr. Sleep. So, okay, I've read it once other. But either way, it's been buried. So it's been a while since I've gone to this book. But definitely a good one. So, well, that's where we're going to start, though, is the book. So I'll go ahead and got a little slide here for that. I got a little animation. So with the book, Basics, it was published in 77. It was King's third novel, and it was actually his first hardback bestseller. So that's kind of a big deal. And also in the intro to the book, King calls this his breakthrough novel. This is kind of the one that kind of put him into the big time. You know, not that I believe that he had paperback bestsellers with Carrie and Salem's Lot, but I don't think that those necessarily put him to the same level. I mean, even consider that, well, I guess Carrie had a quick turnaround because that movie came out in like the late 70s. So I was about to say this is a quick turnaround because it's only 3 years from the publication of the book till the movie comes out. But no, yeah, I guess Carrie was just as quick. So yeah, he's, I don't know. It's hard. I don't necessarily follow authors enough to know, like, I don't know with like all these big young adult novels and stuff that have been big over the last decade or so. I don't know how quickly, like from publication to like movies that those have been, but I don't know. It seems like it's a quick jump for King. You know, like for Carrie, that was adapted within a couple years. And then the same thing here with The Shining. It's just kind of crazy. But then, of course, you get into some other things like the Stand, which would take forever to adapt. But those are kind of the basics of it. I wanted to actually, I thought it would be interesting to, I found a review. This is by Richard Lingman from the New York Times on March 1st, 1977. And this is of the book. And because what I found interesting was like, when I was like looking, there's like things like Goodreads, there's a number of things out there, but every single thing that you look at for reviews is going to mention Kubrick's movie. It's just like one of those things, right?
Yeah.
It's like, I remember I took an archaeology class and I was like, okay, I grabbed the textbook when I first bought it. I'm like, how long until this mentions Indiana Jones, this thing? And it was in the first like two sentences. Like it was like, it mentioned Indiana Jones. It's just one of those things. It's like, if you do, even if it's somebody that's just like 100% like into the book, they have to mention Kubrick's movie. So I'm like, it'd be interesting to see if I could dig up any maybe archived reviews of the book from when it first came out, because that would predate the Kubrick movie. So let me go ahead and hit some of these things here. And this is, again, King's brand new at the time. So Richard here starts as Stephen King is one of the hottest novelists currently working the horror occult genre, which I love that horror occult. That feels very dated. I don't think we use that nomenclature very much anymore. His book Carrie and Salem's Lot were bestsellers in paperback, having been given a considerable boost by the popularity of the movie Carrie. Judging from his latest novel, The Shining, he is a writer fairly engaging and preposterous claptrap. Ranked on a scale from 0 to Ira Levin and Thomas Tyron, to name two leading practitioners of this vein, he would score, I would say, a 75. His long suit is an energetic and febrile imagination and a radar fixed on young people who probably make up a large, hard core of his market. He's not up to Mr. Levin or Mr. Tyron, however, because he lacks the sly craftsmanship of the former and is at his best, and the narrative length of the latter. Still, like a fast, short-order cook during breakfast rush, he serves up scary stuff with unremitting dexterity. So there's kind of your early things, kind of, you know, I don't know. Like, I remember at one point King said that, you know, people kind of equated him to, like, McDonald's. Like, you know, it's not fine dining with King. Like, you're just getting kind of a quick cheeseburger.
Yeah.
And, you know, calling him here, like, referring to him like a short-order cook kind of falls right in that vein. You're only talking a couple years into his career. The horror genre, with its conventions of unnatural or supernatural menace, has attracted great writers from time to time. One thinks of Henry James's Turn of the Screw, which insinuated a notion of evil that inexistent beyond the grave, or Shirley Jackson's The Haunting of Hill House, also an essential ghost story, yet utterly convincing psychologically. The sophisticated horror stories are grounded in some plausible philosophical or psychological ontology, and employ a careful verisimilitude, so that one thinks it could have happened. This guy likes words.
Yeah.
Another kind of horror story descends from the 19th century Gothic, employs primitive fears, superstitions, or legends rattling around the collective unconscious, and contemporary writers often deck these figures in modern guises, which I think is interesting because that's like your werewolves, vampires, stuff like that.
Yeah.
And he says the devil in the Dakota in Rosemary's Baby, or the demonic possession in the post-Vatican II world of The Exorcist. The resurgence of interest in evil spirits in this day, though harmless, occasionally make one wonder if the beast of unreason is stirring. In The Shining, Stephen King resorts to summoning up a melange of ghosts and mixing them with bogus interest in precognition. The story has, and now this is funny because he gets the name wrong here. He says the story has Jack Dorrance, a tentatively reformed drunk and unreformed playwright, taking his wife, Wendy, and 5-year-old son, Danny, for a winter caretake at the Overlook Hotel, an old-style mountain resort in Colorado with a checkered history. Jim intends on using the off-season isolation to complete his play, a labor that shouldn't call down anything worse than the unhappy shade of George Bernard Shaw or maybe George Jean Nathan. Danny, however, is gifted with the shining, precognition, mental telepathy, second sight, or whatever. This, it turns out, makes him an undesired guest at the Overlook, which is booked solid with a convention of evil emanations from its checkered past. The hotel's presiding evil spirits do not take a shine to Danny's shining. For reasons never quite clear, by the miracle of transmorgification, begins wreaking all kinds of bad things on the Dorrances, who are by now thoroughly snowbound. Anyhow, what was something nasty in the bathtub of 217, those unquiet spirits of mafia victims and in the presidential suite, the topiary whose animal-shaped bushes start making unfriendly gestures, the ancient boiler, if not constantly nursed, is going to blow the whole place to Rocky Mountain High, the running 1940s vintage masquerade party in the ballroom, and yes, killer wasps. The Dorrances soon wish that Jack had gone the McDowell route to writing his play. Mr. King serves up the horrors at a brisk, unflagging pace and undeniably keeps things moving. Some of the horrors, however, are embedded in his writing style. He says, we have Wendy, quote, trying to rid herself of the awful pent-up feeling that sometimes fell on her like a large pressing hand over her heart in the hotel palmy days. quote, the money must have rolled down the corridors and into the cash registers like a 20th century Comstock load. And then he goes on and says, Mr. King is one of those writers who tries to fend off the onus of cliches by admitting or underlying it. And he uses an example here, says, for Wendy, it was discovering the truth in a cliche. Her breath was taken away. And then he says he held on, no exaggeration, for dear life. Just kind of using things there. And see, like, maybe this is just like the stuffy guy from like that period.
Yeah.
But like, to me, it's like, I've always felt that like when you're in a movie or something, if you're making a movie and you have to have like some kind of cliche, I've always found it's better to point it out, because then at least you're telling the audience, like, I get it.
Yeah, I get it. I gotta do it. Here it is.
Yeah.
Don't at me, bro.
Yeah. Yeah. It's like, I know it's a cliche, so you kind of hang your hat on it type thing. So it's just funny that he's kind of like, I don't know, kind of hitting King on that a little bit. Let's see. And then, yeah, so it just, he has a little bit more, but ultimately it's not super kind. He's kind of backhanded and whatever. And this reminds me, it actually just came out again recently where King, he said it a number of years ago, but it came, I don't know if he said it again or if it came out again from previous, but he mentioned in an interview that he's outlived all of his critics and that makes him happy. and I'm guessing this might be one of those, because I mean, but at the same time, I just imagine this is 1977. I mean, what's King? He's probably, is he in his 30s or 40? I don't remember, but he's not that old. I can only imagine that this guy writing this is probably like a dude like in his 50s or 60s. And it's just kind of one of those, like, I don't know.
When did you say 77?
77. Yeah.
He was either 29 or 30 years old.
Yeah. So, I mean, it's just one of those things. I just picture this guy is probably some 50-60-year-old dude that's just like, you know, whatever. Definitely full of himself. But no, I found it interesting because, I mean, now we look back in history and see this is a well-regarded novel. You know, this is one of King's more famous novels. And, you know, I don't know. So it's kind of interesting to see. And I kind of tried to do that a little bit with all of these aspects here, is kind of look at them in the context of their time a little bit as kind of intros. So jumping into some questions on it. So when did you first read The Shining?
Oh, I don't remember.
And people in the chat, you guys can answer too.
I don't remember the first time I read it.
But you were an adult.
Oh, yeah. Because for those of you who haven't heard the story, I got introduced to Stephen King by Tad.
In high school.
You started me off pretty slow, but because the whole purpose, correct me if I'm wrong on this, the whole purpose was to get me to like The Dark Tower. And you knew you couldn't just throw that at me first.
Yeah. Yeah. So I don't even think I was that far into it by the time I'd started you down the King path. But I don't remember where The Shining fell into it, because I do know that The Shining is the first one that I ever tried to read. I think I was probably 13 or 14. Definitely not a good book for a kid that age, because there's a lot of adult themes, worries, concerns. There's a lot of stuff involved here that's way more adult oriented that a little, you know, 13-year-old Tad is just not gonna appreciate as much necessarily as adult Tad. So that's the first time I read it, as a wee lad.
I know I read it fairly later. I mean, because you also introduced me to horror films, so I mean, I had seen one horror film.
So even the film you probably saw in high school. Range,
right? I did not see it until later in high school, because I know that for sure. And then when the nice thing about Tad is he gave me simple little nudges in directions he wanted me to go with Stephen King. I remember him starting me off with Salem's Lot, and then I remember him telling me to wait to read three novels. He said, "Don't pick up The Stand, don't pick up It, and don't pick up Pet Sematary," were the three that I remembered. You're just like, you're not ready for those. He's like, and so it almost with that conversation almost became kind of a challenge. It's like, motherfucker, I can handle this. And so that's where.
Also, we were newer friends at the time. So I didn't necessarily know like how much of a reader you were.
Yeah,
or
this,
not,
wasn't,
you know?
this wasn't 15 years of knowing me, Tad. This was knowing me for, you know, a couple years, finding out that I did read, mostly I read Dean Koontz at the time, and saying, hey, there's so much better, come on. And so I remember starting with Salem's Lot, and then I was like, fine, I can't read those ones, but there's nothing stopping me from reading Carrie, Firestarter, all those ones that I really like is because I read them first. It's a big thing. And then it was this, I know that I read The Shining after Salem's, I mean, not after Salem's Lot, after The Stand, and after It. So it was down the list a ways for me. And it was honestly one of the, of the big Stephen Kings, it was one of the last ones I got on audiobook too. Like, okay. I got It first, I got The Stand, I got Firestarter, I got Salem's Lot, even before I got The Shining. And just like you, buried at the bottom of my
audio. Yeah, okay.
Real fast, just because I wanted to go back, I wanted to do a kind of a follow-up with what Tad was saying. That review, just based on the word, just kind of shows, like, we can have an opinion when something comes out.
Yeah.
But just here, this is from PasteMagazine.com. Top 50 horror novels of all time. If you had to guess, Shining's on there. If you had to guess, where would you say it is? All time horror. All time.
Yeah, all time. That's a hard part. Because, I mean, now you're talking like Edgar Allan Poe. You're talking, you know, Mary Shelley. Like, there's all kinds of stuff that's going to be on there. Mm-hmm. I would be... I think it would be pressing my luck to say it was in the top 25. How many did you say it was?
50.
Top 50?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I'd be shocked if it was that far up into the top half, personally. Just because of all the... it's kind of one of those things, like, again, like, and not that I agree with it, but... Okay, let's see here. Now it should be back.
Yeah,
I just refreshed it. Yeah, sorry about that. Now we're probably going to give time for everybody to get back in the thing here. I think it may have booted some people. Yeah, a little unfortunate with internet speeds. Oh, Comcast. Okay, but yeah, while we wait for everyone to join us, are you back in the chat?
Yes.
Okay, so maybe people are already back in the chat. My YouTube, of course, never keeps up to date. It says there's still zero people in the room, but I found that you can't trust that. It never seems to be right. So I also want to mention Dolly in the chat here said audiobook in 2017, movie last year, reading the physical book presently. So, yeah, that's awesome. So newer to The Shining as well. That's awesome. I always love to hear kind of where people come to it. And
yeah.
So that's,
So tell us again, cause you got partway through it. So you tried to read it when you were early, like, I mean, young.
No, I think I got all the way through it. Mm-hmm. It wasn't necessarily
didn't click with everything.
Yeah. Like there was a lot that it was just not registering. Cause again, it's just a pretty adult book, dealing with a lot of adult, concepts and stuff. I don't know. It wasn't really, it didn't necessarily connect with me. Maybe a good example of it would be, like Gunslinger. Yeah. I kind of had a hard time with in terms of like its style wasn't necessarily, what I expected because by that time I was fairly familiar with King and his style and that was definitely not what I was familiar with. So kind of in that way, like, I feel like it was just kind of, I don't know, whatever. And by that point, I mean, I was that old. I mean, by that time I'd probably seen The Shining, you know, a dozen or more times. So I knew the movie back and front, up and down. So it was definitely, that's the way I experienced it. And it sounds like you did too, because I had you watch the movie earlier than you read the book. And I guess that's the other question too, if there's people in the chat that wanted to answer is, you know, did you read the book first or see the movie first? I feel like unless you're old enough to have been around when the movie came out, I would almost venture that more people probably saw the movie first.
Yeah.
Just because it's...
Oh, yeah.
I mean, it's one of the more iconic movies of all time. So I think it's probably... For younger people, it's probably a rare occurrence to read the book first.
Yeah.
Would be my guess, but that's just speculation. So jumping over to the questions, the question section for the book. So this is the one I put on, one of the ones I posed on Twitter. Where does The Shining rank for you in all of King's catalog? First op choice is 1 through 3. Next one's 4 through 10. Next one's 11 through 25. And the last one is not in the top 25 at all. So,
I know that it for sure made my top 10.
We I don't think we've done books. We did adaptations.
Didn't we do books?
No, I think
I could have sworn we did.
We've talked about it, but I don't think we've actually. I don't remember. I looked it up in the archive that I've gotten. I couldn't find anything.
That's what I was going to look. I was like, I gotta have a thing here in my
I found our books. Our adaptations I found, but I didn't find books. I think we've talked about that maybe even in the last 6 months about maybe doing that, but I'm not sure that we did. So
I don't think. So I mean, The Shining was pretty low for me on adaptation, but for books. Not 1 through 3. What was the second option?
4 through 10.
Yeah, I'd be there.
Okay. So you fall in line with a lot of our listeners. So, number one choice by our listeners, 56%, was 4 through 10. Mm-hmm. So it looks like it's basically a top 10 book for most people. The next highest is 21% at 1 through 3. So 20% of the people, has it in the top 3 percentile. And then 18%, have it in the 11 through 25 range, with 5%, saying not in the top 25 at all. So, which is, yeah, that's awesome. And I remember I posted a comment on there as well, just said, you know, keep it civil. I don't want people, you know, whatever. It's subjective,
yeah.
Ultimately.
It's opinion,
yeah. Yeah, so that found that interesting. And, yeah, so you fall right in line with the lion's share of the listeners that voted on that poll. So
the topiary lion's share?
So, topiary-wise, which of them freaks you out more? Because the rabbit seemed like pretty sinister.
It seemed pretty sinister in the book. To me, it's the lions, especially because in the miniseries, because there's 3 of them.
Yeah.
Like, which one do I look at? And that's the thing that gets you from the book, is that Jack says it. You can't keep your eyes on all of them.
Yeah.
So that, I honestly, dude, I got to be honest with you. Going back through all this stuff, I completely forgot about the hedge animals. You talk about it all the time.
Yeah, no, man.
But it's one of those things that's like, I hear it, but I don't register it.
Yeah.
That Tad talks about the hedge animals because
that scene with like mostly Jack more so than Danny, but the Jack scene with it and the Danny in room 217, kind of like what Jack in room 217 doesn't register with me as bad as Danny, but Danny in the room, Jack with the topiaries, those two things fucking chill my blood, man. That's like, that's just the way that King writes it, is just fucking blood chilling.
Oh yeah, for sure.
So like, yeah, I don't know, but yeah, there, and I don't know. That may be one of the things that both of those things are probably the primary reasons I have long been a proponent of a new adaptation in the modern day. Mm-hmm. You know, get Flanagan or someone to do a...
If Flanagan could do a Shining remake, it's actually something I have on my list to talk about is... You asked this of me. Oh, geez, what was it? 2-3 months ago?
So let me give you the breakdown of how we're doing it. So we're going to go book, movie, miniseries, spoof, and then global. So I have some questions at the bottom that are kind of like ones that synopsize, like that kind of cover multiple things, just to kind of lay it out, just so in case you were going in a realm that might fit better in that last section.
Yep.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. So you read it for the first time. I got that question. So how often do you revisit it? You mentioned that it was toward the bottom of your list.
This time would be only my second time on Audible, which will be my third time reading it total, because I read physical copy.
Yeah.
First time. Actually, I think I...
Paperback edition.
I don't know if it's paperback. I might actually own it on my Kindle, because I think that's when I switched to reading on my phone, which was horrible for my eyes. Reading on... Because this is before, you know, like, phone screens got even bigger, to where they are now.
Yeah.
Before they became, you know, mini tablets, basically.
Flablets.
Flablets. Yeah, that's a good way of putting it. I like that.
Yeah. That's usually like the Samsung Note. They call those flablets because they're like halfway between a tablet
and
a phone.
Well, it's like me and my sister we'll go out and she'll, hey, hold my phone for me while she's driving or something. Or I have her hold my phone. And it's always the same conversation as, man, your phone's so big, when I'm talking to her, because she gets one of those flablets. I can't say that word. Flablets?
Yeah.
Flablets.
Yeah.
I can hide my phone behind her phone, and you can't see any of it. And then when she holds my phone, she's like, how do you do anything on this? It's so small. And then I think back to when I was reading on my phone. They were even smaller than the phone I have now.
Yeah.
And like, I know that I have, from a Buick 8, the stand I know is on there, and I'm pretty sure that I have The Shining on there as well. So
okay,
this is only my third time through The Shining.
Okay, so and for me, I don't go through. So I guess for me, it's like the stand is top of my list. I go through that yearly. Dark Tower, probably every, I think I usually say about every other year. I feel like it's not necessarily a full year, or it's more than a full year. Usually by the time I revisit the Dark Tower, sometimes it's even 2 years. And then from there, like, I don't know how many of King's books I actually revisit that often, to be honest with you. But I do think that with this, for this podcast, going back and reading the Shining, it probably puts it up in the next realm. 'Cause that's probably the sixth time or so that I've gone through it in terms of, like, you know, once when I was like 13 or something, and then like, yeah, a number of times as an adult. So yeah, it's probably up there for me. But having said that, the caveat being outside of Dark Tower and The Stand, I don't reread a lot. In fact, I think I was telling you off air recently that I was looking through my Audible and realized I don't have It.
Mm-mm.
And I believe last time I did it, it's because I did it, I bought the audiobook on iTunes and listened to it on my iPod. So it's like, it's been a while since I've read it, gone through and done
and,
it.
And to give you context of when that was 2007 to possibly 2010, because that was when we were both using Sidekick phones and had iPods for listening to music and audiobooks and everything like that. Because that's right around the time that I was... listening to the Harry Potter series for the first time on audiobook.
Yeah.
I'd read all the novels, but first time listening to them was on the iPod, because I could only fit one book at a time on my Nano.
Yeah.
Because that was before I got the classic that you showed me that has, like, you know, 30 gigabytes. I think it's the first one that we had and everything. But that just gives you context of how long ago that was for him, for it.
Yeah, it's been a while. Yeah. So in general, this Shining, I guess, does kind of get into the top realm, cream of the crop. Now, kind of a secondary part of that question is, after doing this, you know, reading, watching everything, do you think that it'll change at all, or do you think that the Shining is going to probably be another good while before you go back to it?
It's probably going to be a little bit before I go back to it, just because I've had such a heavy dose. I mean, I watched the miniseries that I've never seen before, the movie, the book, you know, that's a pretty heavy dose of, you know, same characters, different iterations of them.
Yeah.
You know, it's still Jack, it's still Wendy, it's still Danny, it's still Dick, you know, it's still the Overlook and everything.
Yeah.
But it's still a heavy dose of it. I mean, that's the same as, you know, watching the new Stand miniseries, watching the old Stand miniseries, and then listening to the audiobook.
Oh, I'm going
to
do it, man.
Oh, I know
just
you are.
Just it to my veins.
I know you are. You're psycho, but yeah, you are.
I'm gonna do the, right, like, literally, like, once I'm done with this, I might even, like, go to dinner tonight afterwards. I'm probably going to have the Stand going as I
drive.
Yeah, as I drive. So I'm ready for that, and then after that, I'll do the miniseries, and then hopefully the new series is coming out not long, hopefully. I mean, hopefully it's
Hopefully this year.
Yeah.
Possibly next year. But for me, The Shining...
So you don't think it'll change then?
I don't think it will change.
Because I have my
set books that I go to.
Because It is your big one, right? That's...
No.
I feel like you go to It way more than...
I do go to It a lot, but I go through a rotation of King where it's usually It and The Stand kind of interchange, where it's like, okay, I need a big book, I need a lengthy book, I need one that has some horror elements to it.
Yeah.
It's It or The Stand for me there. When I want to punish myself, it's going to be The Shining or Pet Sematary, because I'm a family man and that just hurts. Both of those just hurt so bad. For pure enjoyment, Carrie, Firestarter are my big ones.
Yeah.
I mean, you know how I feel about Carrie and Firestarter.
I think, honestly, I only read it this year for the first time, but I think The Dead Zone might be on my list now. For
The Dead Zone's pretty good.
That was really good. I could find myself going back to that one quite a bit, because that was a damn good one.
It's real easy for me to put an audiobook on that I've listened to before, because it's a comfort thing that I don't have to pay too close attention, because I know what happens.
Yeah.
Especially something like It, where there's now, again, three iterations of it.
Yeah.
You know, there's the Tim Curry miniseries, the new two movies, and the book.
Yeah.
And it's like, oh yeah, this is the part where Bed encounters his mummy. That's not in any of the others, you know.
Yeah.
The way that it happens here on the bridge in the chilling January air.
Yeah.
But, you know, for me, the Shining, I think it kind of, well, okay, I gotta be perfectly honest, this is gonna be kind of an unpopular opinion, I kind of was upset at Stephen King for a little bit there. I know it's his, But it's like, come on, dude. Stanley Kubrick's movie is amazing. Like, yeah. How can you be mad at him?
I know. I feel like kind of the child between the two divorced parents when it comes to King and Kubrick. Because I'm just like,
how can you be mad at such a great film?
Yeah.
But the more I look at it, especially after seeing the miniseries and seeing what King's vision looked like on film, I kind of get his point a little bit more, which is going to lower that almost
divide.
Divide is a great way of putting it. I almost said resentment, but the divide between the film and the book, and it's going to make it a little bit easier. The problem is it's going to make the movie just a little bit harder for me.
Yeah.
Like there was parts rewatching the movie that I was like, I get why King's upset at this.
Yeah.
Like,
no,
I get it.
And that's the thing is I get it from all sides, really. That's why I say I feel like the kid between the two divorced parents. Like, I can't pick a side. Like, I love King. I love Kubrick. I feel like I'm kind of raised by both of them in a lot of ways. My childhood is defined by, you know, The Shining and definitely by King's stuff. I mean, it's just kind of one of those things. It's hard for me to pick one and say, yes, like, this one's right because I love them both. I think they both have their points. So I've already tipped my hand on this one, but what do you think is the most terrifying, quote, scene of the book? What gets you the most in the book here?
For me?
You got room 217 with both characters.
Yeah.
You got the topiaries. You've got...
I'm wanting to say one of those two.
You've got the end
are...
with Jack kind of chasing Danny and stuff.
I think that when Jack snaps that... That gets me over the topiary and room 217. I think because Danny survived 217 and Jack survived the topiary. So it's kind of like, oh, close call. You know, it's like where you almost step onto traffic. Oh, but I'm not scared of traffic.
Yeah.
Like, I'm not terrified. I'm more cautious, but I'm not terrified. But when Jack goes, when this happens, what's on the thumbnail right now, you know, Jack with the rook mallet, with the knife in his back and everything.
Yeah.
Full blown, he's ready to murder there.
Yeah.
And that's where, for me, you know, if I put myself in Danny's shoes, or if I put myself in Jack's shoes as a father, that's the most terrifying to me.
Yeah.
I mean, dude, as a kid, there's nothing more terrifying than your parent losing their goddamn mind.
No, I mean, yeah, and if you think about looking into, like, younger adult horror stuff, mm-hmm. a lot of it has to do with that. Like, your parents are, like, replaced by aliens. Like, usually the most terrifying shit is, like, something where, for some reason, your parents are not...
Your parents.
Yeah, mm-hmm. or they don't believe, like, Chucky. One of the reasons Chucky's so terrifying, because his mom won't believe him.
No.
That his doll's alive and trying to kill him, and you know what I mean? Like,
it means you're alone.
Yeah, like, yeah. So you're alone with it. You know, it's just like, yeah, that's a tough one. Yeah, definitely. And I don't even know that necessarily King necessarily even plays it as hard, because I feel like he's kind of covering everyone. So I feel like with Danny, like, he's so scared throughout the book of kind of the vision he had that I don't know that do we really get that much of a reaction that is his dad, or by the time it happens, he's already kind of understanding what's going on. Like, he doesn't have that betrayal and fear as much like we do as an audience, because it's like, oh shit, the dad's snapped, he's about to kill his wife and kid. But like, I don't know that you get it from Danny. Like, you don't get like the kid from Child's Play
mm-hmm.
like vibe from Danny, because by the time you get to that point, Danny kind of already knows what's going on. He already knows it's inevitable, because there's a certain point where he realizes what's happening.
Yeah.
And he's like, there's no stopping it now. We're snowed in. Like, we're done.
The
like,
snowmobile's gone, the radio's gone.
Yeah.
Like, we're this is going to happen. I just have to be ready when it does.
Yeah. What did you enjoy the most about the book in terms of enjoyment? Like, you know, like, you got fear, yeah, but what about enjoyment? Like,
you know, it's one thing to say that I enjoy the pacing of a book. The setting is horrifying, being isolated with someone who's slowly losing their mind.
Yeah.
That can overpower you.
And the hotels are inherently creepy, aren't they?
Oh, they are.
I mean, like...
I stayed at one last weekend for the first time since this whole quarantine business. Went down to visit my in-laws. We always stay at a hotel down there. It is. It's
like,
just
hotels
creepy.
Feel like an alien that doesn't really understand humanity got, like, the basic gist of a house, and they tried to put one together, and, like, that's what a hotel is. Like,
here's
it's
your bathroom,
just,
here's
yeah,
your bedroom.
But none of it feels like homey, you know, it just feels like odd, alien, weird. Like nothing, nothing about hotels is ever comforting. I've never been in a hotel where I'm like, wow, this is actually really nice. Like really, like it feels right. Like it always just feels off.
My family did a lot of traveling when I was a kid, so a lot of vacations, a lot of stays in hotels. For me, it's this is the hotel. This is a hotel.
Yeah.
This isn't home.
Yeah.
This is a hotel. And my brain can even pick that out. You know, a lot of people will wake up, where am I? This isn't familiar.
Yeah.
Me, I instantly wake up and go, vacation.
Yeah.
That's just how my brain is wired. It even was the same this weekend, this past week. Spent four days up in Idaho with my side of the family at a family reunion. We rented a house up there. Even though I woke up in a completely strange place instantly, still, I know where I am. I don't suffer from that as much with hotels and that. You know when I have that is camping. I don't know what it is, but when you put me in a tent, it's like, wait, I'm not in a building. What the hell's going on?
Yeah.
Like, well, that's where.
I mean, a little tiny thing of whatever tents or canvas. Yeah, I was blanking on the word. You know, that's not going to stop a beast, you know?
No, it's not. thanks for pointing that out there, Ted.
Oh, you're welcome.
Hashtag Ted is terrible.
For me, you know what's actually funny is because every time I hit it, I just, like, whatever. It's everything with Dick Halloran. Mm-hmm. I absolutely fucking adore him. And everything about him, especially his conversation with Danny, I don't know why, but that just overjoys me. Oh, yeah. I just love that. I don't know why. Loving the movie, too. I think maybe it's just kind of one of those things where it's like, as a child, no matter what, there's at least some aspect that you feel like an outsider. There's a time that you go with, like, one friend to another group of friends, then the one friend, like, gets detached, and now you're in a group of strangers, or like you're in a new class at school. There's always some ways that like children just know that feeling.
Mm-hmm.
And I feel like Danny, that's his whole life. And like at being only 5 years old, having to deal with like this issue, and then to finally have someone that like understands and can explain to him. Like, I don't know. I find a great joy in that quite a bit. So that's definitely it for me as Dick. He's one of my favorites. Dolly in the chat says, I was underwhelmed by the movie. The camera work is amazing, but that's that has nothing to do with the source material. But who's ever happy with a novel adaptation? Yeah, definitely. That's definitely true. Now, here's a question. Is there ever, in terms of adaptation, like, I guess it'd be interesting to look at adaptation-wise, like, what are ones that are, like, more iconic than, like, The Shining? You know what I mean? Like, movie adaptations. Because, like,
Godfather?
The movie is so big that it's, like...
Yeah.
I mean, I would say a lot of people, I mean, there's very few that overshadow the book. You know, Godfather
be
one.
I think Godfather is, because if you ask 100 people nowadays who have seen, you know, split it 50-50, who have seen, who have not seen. Have you seen The Godfather? Yes. Did you know there was a novel? I would be safe. I think I would be safe in saying less than 50% would say, yes, I knew there was a novel.
Yeah.
Even the ones who have seen the movie where it says... In the movie,
yeah,
you know,
yeah.
I think The Shining is more famous as a book versus other adaptations.
Yeah,
because I mean, like, I've even ran across people where it's like, oh man, The Hunger Games, and it's like, yeah, you know, I read the series when I was, you know, just out of high school. Oh, it's a book series? It's like, it is.
Yeah.
You know,
Is there anything about the book that you're not as fond of?
Versus the movie, or just
in general? Like, sometimes, like, when you're getting ready to go into a book and you, like, maybe there's, like, a scene that sticks out to you or, like, a portion of the book that sticks out to you where you're just like, I'm not looking forward to that, you know? And maybe if it comes down to, like, a debate where you're holding two books in your hand to reread, like, maybe there's something that makes you choose the other book. Is there something like that in The Shining? I mean, you mentioned the family stuff, not necessarily being a fan of it. Like it's almost, like, punishing to have to, like,
It's what it comes down to is that side of it. It's just like with Pet Sematary, it's the tragedy side of it. Jack's slow descent into madness is so frustrating because Wendy asks Danny right before the first really big snowstorm, Doc, you know, like, are we going to be okay? Like, is daddy going to be okay? And he's like, I don't know. I don't think so. And she's like, okay, let's go to my mom's house. And then Danny's like, no, don't take me there. And it's like, dude, like,
yeah.
I know you're 5 and I shouldn't be putting the weight of the world on you like this, but
that's the sad thing about King is he puts the weight of the world on Danny.
He does.
Cause he knows
he does this a lot in his books. He puts the weight on people who don't deserve it.
Yeah.
Or
because like a 5-year-old thinking about the utter ruin of his dad's career. He's thinking about like his mom's hatred for her mom. Like there's like a lot.
Divorce.
There's a lot. Yeah.
The big D word is a huge part of it.
Yeah. So that's just it's unfair for a 5-year-old to have all of that shit. Because like even when you get to that conversation with Wendy, like, you know, Danny isn't just talking about just pure safeness. He has to consider those things. And it's like, 5-year-olds shouldn't have to consider shit like that.
No,
you know?
He shouldn't.
Like,
no, absolutely not. And that's that part of it is what gets me. It's like, yes, I get frustrated because that's, you know, like that's the avoidable scene there. But the question then comes to me, and I got thinking about it this time, which I've never had before. What happens if Danny and Wendy do cry off and go somewhere else, even if it is to her mom's? What happens to Jack?
Yeah.
Is Jack able to be brought in by the Overlook if he doesn't have a sacrifice?
I think he probably is, but I'm not sure that he's as
valuable,
as desirable. Like, they want Danny, you know?
That's what I'm saying is, would the Overlook even bother that at that point? It would just go back to sleep and wait for one that was worth its time.
Yeah, possibly.
So, you know, I don't think so. I think that's, you know, where, like, the drama is, and that's where Danny's decision is that, you know, yes, me and Mommy could go to Grandma's house and be miserable. I could hate it, but at the same time, I don't think Daddy would come back.
Yeah.
And that, I think, is the big deciding
point. And he's closer to his dad, too.
That's an interesting part of the book that I always forget about, is that... There's like this resentment from Wendy because it's always been Dad, even though he broke his arm.
Yeah,
it's still Dad.
Yeah, and also like it is more atypical because usually the child attracts more to the opposite sex parent, like mommy's boy
mama's
and daddy's
boy.
Little girl.
Yeah.
Like that's generally, I mean, not that you can't always stereotype, but like that is a general thing that's like it happens.
It exists for a reason.
Yeah.
It's not one of those like negative stereotypes where it's like, you know, just people being jerks. It's me and my wife have had this conversation about things. It exists for a reason.
Yeah.
There is not scientific data backing this up, but there are enough examples that it's a reason, like you said, mama's boy and daddy's little girl.
Yeah.
There's a reason that exists is because it does happen a lot.
Yeah. So for me, trying to answer this question, I don't know. I don't know if there is anything necessarily, especially now as an adult, because I feel like I'm, you know, what tripped me up as a kid, not really understanding the more adult stuff of it. You know, now I understand that stuff more. So I don't know that I necessarily have anything that I'm not as fond of. Like, I try to put that question in general, just, you know, whatever. But doesn't mean there has to be an answer. But, like, I'm trying to think if there's anything that, like, I don't know. Like, I don't go back to this book as much as, like, the Stand. But, like, there's nothing where I'm just like, oh, God, I don't want this part of the book. Like, not that it's good, you know. Like, there's shit that's, like, not fun to, like, you know, like Jack's dad stuff is, like, pretty heinous shit. But, like, it's not, like, one of those things where I'm, like, cringing I guess the only one that – I think the closest that comes for me that love, like whatever is the fight with his friend that got him the job. I'm just blanked on his fucking name.
Al,
I was thinking Jack.
Al Sharpton?
Shockley.
Shockley.
Yeah, the fight with him about the book. That's a rough one, maybe, in terms of, like, you know, but again, that's good storytelling. So it's like, I don't like it. It's probably, like, the most uncomfortable I get in the book, but it's such good storytelling.
Well, it's the same as, you know, like, I'm a big fan of the light side in Star Wars, but, you know, I still like watching Empire Strikes Back.
Yeah.
But there's a big reason why it's not my favorite movie.
Yeah.
You know,
it's
kind of thing. I think I just had an epiphany when it comes to The Shining. I think I'm going to do what you talked about. You haven't reread Dr. Sleep either.
No.
I think that's going to be my thing is that instead of just... Because I've read Dr. Sleep 3 times now. I've read Dr. Sleep as many times as I have The Shining.
Yeah.
And I've been introduced to The Shining a lot longer.
Yeah.
I think that's where it's going to change is I need to read them back to back because... Conjoined. Here's the reason why I enjoyed Dr. Sleep more than I enjoyed The Shining. Man, The Shining is a bleak, black book.
Yeah.
That doesn't have that ray of sunshine. Go look at most of Stephen King's books.
Except for Pet Sematary.
Exactly why I don't reread Pet Sematary. It's hard to... I bring it back to this. I've mentioned it before. It's the Schindler's List. Man, that movie is hard to watch.
Yeah, it's a good movie, but it's...
It's hard.
It's not one you just throw on an afternoon and go, oh, let's go some light watching. Throw on Schindler's List. No, yeah, like, no, that's one that's like...
It's one you have to be in a very particular mood. You have to be ready for it. You have to be, you know, for some of us, I know Tad's not this way, but for me, dude, sometimes I got to have a box of tissues ready when I'm ready to watch it. It's that kind of just, like, disturbing. I can't believe another human being would do this. Pet Sematary and The Shining are there. But I think that The Shining is going to be different now because it's going to be The Shining followed by Dr. Sleep.
Yeah.
Which does have that ray of hope because not only do I have Danny's conclusion.
Yeah.
I also have Abra's story.
Yeah.
Which I freaking adore. I mean, I know we're not talking Dr. Sleep, but yeah. I think that's an epiphany that literally just occurred to me that The Shining needs to be paired with Dr. Sleep. It needs to not be separate. It needs to go hand in hand just like the Mr. Mercedes series.
Yeah, yeah, that's true. That is true. Now, the first time you read the Dark Tower series, did you at any time expect anything from The Shining to crop up?
No, because it was a movie first versus the book. And
I mean, we get mentions of The Shining.
We do.
Like for me, I will say going into those last three books of the Dark Tower series, I actually did wonder if we would end up either in the overlook. I don't know why. It was just one of those things like, are we going to end up in Colorado, you know, at Sidewinder or something? Like, there was just some part of me that wondered because every time they would go through a door into our world, I was just like wondering, like, okay, are we going to jump into somewhere that I've seen before? And this is one of the big ones. Like, the Overlook would be one of the big, like...
I didn't read The Shining before The Dark Tower, so I didn't have that.
Oh, okay.
I didn't have that expectation. Because I only had the movie
to
go off of. And that's where the disconnect for me is that it's, you know, the movie is not approved by King.
Yeah.
Not looked on favorably by King. So I don't imagine that he would reference it.
Okay.
As much as he does his other books.
Yeah. Yeah. All right. Well, do you have any other closing thoughts on the book before we move into the movie?
I like the narrator.
Yeah. You know, I was thinking it was someone else, and when it started, I was just like, oh, no, this isn't who I was expecting, but it works, definitely, for me. Like, it definitely works with the narrative that you have in the book there. It's not...
Campbell Scott,
yeah. I don't think he's one that does a lot. I don't know if I've heard him in any of the other King's works, or even any of their audiobooks that are not King. So now, moving over to the film. The movie 1980 by Stanley Kubrick.
Good.
I love this. I thought about the picture in the door frame, but I just had
to. It's too easy. It's too easy.
Yeah, I had to go this route. So on the basics here, Kubrick was trying to do something basically art that he could. That he would find artistically fulfilling, but also that would have commercial success, because up to this point he had made three or four films, but none of them had any financial success, so to speak. Like, there was like pockets, like there was Europe was a fan of one of his movies. There was a small like niche following of some of his movies in America, but there was no breakout success. So that's kind of where how he approached this. And then there's a story, I don't know how true or not it is. It's one that gets told a lot, though, that he basically had a bunch of his people that work for him bring him just basically fucking stacks of horror books. And he was just trying to find what he wanted to do next. And the story is they were outside the room and they would hear books hitting the wall as he was throwing them, like tried to read and then throw them across the room and stuff and just whatever. And then after a while, suddenly the thumping of books against the wall stopped. And after a while, still didn't happen. Still happened. So they went in and he was reading The Shining. So, you know, found it, you know, something that he had liked. So it was filmed in 79. It was released on May 23rd, 1980. Now, here's an interesting thing. Well, so the other thing, too, is there was some concern because by the time you were getting ready for release, there was already some reviews out and the reviews were not favorable. I don't know if a lot of people know this. I only learned this a couple years ago, but it was not at all well received. The Shining, like not at all, not in the least. There was a lot of negative reviews.
I knew that it wasn't a ton of positive, but I didn't know that it was a ton of negative.
Yeah. We'll get into it. But okay. So ultimately the studio was like, what can we do to try to alleviate the bad press and stuff? So what they decided to do is a kind of strategic thing where they would release it only on a number of screens in New York and LA and then allow some word of mouth and then slowly start to up screens a little bit and kind of slowly roll the movie out. So that's what they ended up doing. But here's the interesting thing. May 23rd, 1980. Is there any reason that that date might ring a bell to anyone?
May 23rd, 1980?
There's another big movie that released that weekend. You already mentioned it this episode.
Empire Strikes Back. Oh, damn.
So, I mean, it was in limited theaters, but yeah, it opened the same weekend as Empire Strikes Back. So, that's a...
I seriously just went through my head, 77, 80, 83. Oh, shit.
And May, you know, it's right in that right close to Memorial Day time period. Yeah, that's Star Wars time period. So, yeah, that's interesting. The budget for the film, $19 million, with the box office, ended up bringing in a $46.2 million. And here's an interesting little tidbit just to kind of go along with what I was talking about reviews. It was the only one of Kubrick's last nine movies. Like if you block his last nine movies out, this falls within that. It's the only one in that nine that didn't get an Oscar nomination.
That's a shame. How did it not get nominated for at least cinematography?
Yeah, you'd think. So let's jump into reviews and reactions at release. So
here we go.
Here's a review of the movie from Variety, and this is credited from the Variety staff, so there's no name given. Mm-hmm. The article's released on New Year's Eve 1979, so interestingly, that's like 6 months before the movie comes out. You know, if it comes out in May, and this is coming out New Year's Eve of 79, that's a... That's a long time before the fucking movie review. This is a short thing. With everything to work with, director Stanley Kubrick has teamed with jumpy Jack Nicholson to destroy all that was so terrifying about Stephen King's bestseller. In this book, King took a fundamental horror formula, an innocent family marooned in an evil dwelling with a grim history, and built layers of ingenious terror upon it. The father is gradually possessed by a demonic desolate hotel. With the dad going mad, the only protection the mother and the child have is the boy's clairvoyance, his, quote, shining, which allows him an innocent understanding and some ability to outmaneuver the devils. But Kubrick sees things his own way, throwing 90% of King's creation out. The crazier Nicholson gets, the more idiotic he looks. Shelley Duvall transforms the warm and sympathetic wife of the book into a simplified, or into a simpering, semi-retarded hysteric. So... not very kind review wise here. And then it says version review ran 146 minutes, but Kubrick cut the picture soon after its premiere. And that's a thing of legend as well. I don't know. Are you aware of that?
No.
So, So originally there was a scene at the end that was filmed and it was released even. And so they reviewed it with this and it released the first weekend. And then Kubrick basically made the cut after the opening weekend. And Warner Brothers basically demanded every theater had to cut this portion of the movie, the film, and mail it back to Warner Brothers to completely change the... So at the end, there was originally a scene where Wendy and Danny are at the hospital, and Ullman...
Sidewinder.
And Ullman's there, and mm-hmm. they're like, you know, we've looked everywhere, we can't find the... There's no body anywhere. Like, we can't find your husband.
Oh, shit.
And then he gives Danny the ball, the tennis ball. So like that he found. Oh. So like that, I mean, there were some reviews I read, like even, I think Ebert, even had one where he's just like, I'm glad they cut it because he's like, it was just a bridge too far that like, the body's gone now. Like he just felt that. And apparently Kubrick, there's something about it that Kubrick didn't like either. So, and that's actually a very, very, sought after thing. There was actually, when the 4K remaster happened here in the last 6 months when it got released, there was actually a huge hope amongst horror fans that they may have discovered maybe some film of that and they would put it in there as a special feature or something, because it's still, that hasn't been seen since opening weekend 1980. That scene, like, that's
damn.
That's like footage, that's like a Holy Grail type stuff of like footage that people want to see. But yeah, I don't know. It's and that's just a crazy story in terms of cutting a movie after it premieres. So that's interesting. And then New York Times, this is an interesting one. I'll take some excerpts from New York Times review by Janet Maslin on June 8th, 1980. So right closer to the release, a little bit after the release, actually. So just some excerpts I have from her review. The hotel chef in The Shining is supposed to have a remarkable psychic powers, but the movie never explains the strangest of this man's idiosyncrasies. He can smell trouble from Miami to Colorado, but he doesn't detect a killer standing 10 feet away from him, armed with an axe and wearing a horrible grin. I mean, I'm going to take issue with that, though. He's not sensing danger. Danny's calling him. So
yeah, there's a big difference.
Yeah, there. I mean, of course, me, I've grown up on this movie and seen it countless times. Like, Janet may have only seen it once, so maybe that's one of those things that I don't know, but it made me laugh. The movie's ghostly butler now this is one I actually never knew before. The movie's ghostly butler starts out with the name of Charles Grady, but then somehow becomes Delbert Grady before the story's finished. Did you ever realize that his name changes in the movie?
No.
When Ullman tells him the story at the beginning, it's Charles Grady, but then when he meets them at the end, the ghost, it's Delbert. He says Delbert Grady's his name. I mean, there's all kinds of fan theories that people come up with in terms of, like,
middle,
you know,
name.
Charles Grady was the man that was hired, and then Delbert Grady is the name of the demon base or whatever. Like, that's the name he gets as he becomes part of the hotel.
Or it's Delbert Charles Delbert
yeah,
Grady.
Yeah, I mean, it could be something like that.
That he goes
too.
By Delbert, you know.
Yeah.
To his friends.
Or Ullman could just be mistaken. I mean, it was his predecessor, he says, that hired him, so it wasn't necessarily his employee. The caption on a closing, and then she goes on here, the caption on a closing photograph of Jack Nicholson's utterly defies explanation. And the director, Stanley Kubrick, once again leaves his audience asking a familiar question. How can anyone make a film so fastidiously beautiful and still leave so many loose ends? The Shining may be a horror film, but it's very much fits the Kubrick mold. First and foremost, it's mesmerizingly lovely. So handsome, you may be halfway out the theater before those nagging questions arise. Yet, like Clockwork Orange or 2001 A Space Odyssey, this movie barely makes sense upon examination. Most of the small details seem meticulously chosen, but there's no evidence that the corresponding care has been taken with the film's central concerns. But when Shelley Duvall, and then I skipped a little bit ahead because now she gets into, like, the plot. But when Shelley Duvall, who plays the frightened wife to Jack Nicholson's crazy killer, is besieged by the Overlook's hotel's full array of ghosts at the movie's end, the visions of cobweb, torrents of blood, ghouls at a party, and one mysterious figure in a bear suit are preposterous. Worse, they seem to have absolutely no bearing upon the rest of the film. So it's just funny that, like, the stuff that people pick out, like, it's just hilarious. The morality of The Shining is so ill-defined that the film never creates a clear sense of whether there's anything wrong with the man's murdering his wife and child. Kubrick's directorial sympathies, such as they are, seem evenly split among the husband, the film's most likable character, even at his most bloodthirsty, it says in parentheses, his family, and in parentheses, their point of view is necessary, if only to generate suspense, and the hotel, which has a rather bewildering mind of its own, which is a common thing with Kubrick, is people talk about that his stuff tends to not have a lot of humanity in it, and it tends to be kind of very cold and distant, and I think that's maybe what she's getting at a little bit there. And then she says Kubrick made a cut to The Shining the weekend after it opened, eliminating a slow scene near the ending. The change is minor and it doesn't substantially improve the film. If anything, it is mildly damaging. The deleted scene imparted no new information, but it helped maintain the film's languid, eerie rhythm. Without it, the ending is perhaps a little bit more economical, but it's also more abrupt. And the change seems especially senseless since the problem of The Shining were not remedied so easily, and since the movie's drawbacks are so inexorably linked with its genius. So I wanted to read hers because she at least gives it some credit. She's not completely shitting on it.
Yeah.
You know, she is definitely giving Kubrick credit for, you know, what he's what he has with this movie. But it does still have a lot of negativity to it. And overall, yeah, the reviews are not great at the time. And here's an interesting one that I think that might be interesting to know as well. So in terms of capping those reviews, one thing it's ghastly to me, but the Razzies, you know, you're familiar with the Razzies.
Yeah. Catwoman made me very familiar with the Razzies. It's for shitty movies.
Yeah. It's basically the opposite of the Oscars. Yeah. Like the bizarro world of the Oscars.
Catwoman, when that movie came out, was the first time I ever heard of the Razzies, was because, like, didn't Halle Berry actually show up?
Or
she was like, yeah, this is a shitty movie.
Showed up to take her award. Cause nobody shows up, obviously.
No, obviously.
It's a negative thing. So the first time, it was originally called the Raspberry Awards, and I think maybe it's still called that, but it's kind of like the Academy Awards versus Oscars. They just call it Razzies.
Yeah.
So the first time it was held was in 1981. So in review of 1980.
Okay.
Was the very first inaugural Razzies. That year, there was a nomination for Stanley Kubrick as Worst Director.
Wow.
For The Shining.
Wow.
He didn't win, but he was nominated for Worst Director for The Shining. So just to give you a cherry on top of just to give you an idea that, yeah, you know, Janet was a little bit kinder, you know, but,
yeah,
you know, the Variety one is maybe a little bit more in line with what a lot of people are thinking, because
public opinion.
Yeah, it wasn't good. Critics didn't like it. But of course, we know now, it's just like we said with the book. It's funny to now look in retrospect and see that The Shining is probably considered one of the greatest horror movies of all time. I know that it's funny, because another one that's very similar to this in terms of bad reviews and stuff is
Shawshank Redemption.
No, The Thing.
Really?
Yeah. So The Thing and The Shining, like, if I'm going to put like greatest horror movies of all time, those are both going to be in like the top five or maybe top three. Like for me, I'm probably going to go like Halloween, you know, Halloween, The Shining, and The Thing would probably be my top three horror movies of all time without thinking too hard about it. And yeah, two of those had dismal ratings and reviews at the time, but then got obviously more popular as time went by.
The Shining has an 8.4 out of 10 on IMDb.
Yeah, doesn't surprise me. I'm guessing Rotten Tomatoes would be fairly good as well.
Should we check it?
I'll
pull it up.
All right, well, we'll jump over to the questions for the movie. So you already mentioned you saw it for the first time around high school time period.
Yeah, when I had before you watch I even it. Read the book.
Yeah, I don't know when I saw it. Would have definitely been I saw it a number of times by the time I read it when I was 13. So somewhere between age 5 when I saw my first horror movie and age 13, somewhere in the 8-year period, I saw it a number of times. So, yeah.
Tomato meter, so that's the critics.
Yeah.
85%. Audience score, 93%.
Yeah.
Surprisingly enough, you know Rotten Tomatoes better than me. How many critics' reviews are there usual for a film?
I think it depends. I don't know.
There's only 91 for this.
That's a lot, actually.
Is it?
Them.
Okay.
Yeah, there's a lot. They'll be on there. They'll have like 10, 15, 20.
Audience score, 481,000.
Yeah.
A lot of people have seen this movie.
Yeah. So I was going to ask a similar question as the book. Where do we rank it in terms of... actually, this is a new question. Where do you rank it all time for horror? I just kind of gave my answer by saying I'd probably put it number 2. Just
it'd be top 5.
Just shooting from the hip, not top thinking 5. Too hard. Okay, top 5.
Yeah.
And I mentioned for King adaptations, we both put it at number 2. Both of us matched on that.
Yeah.
So for King adaptations, we both have it second only to The Shawshank Redemption. I pulled up our old one from old episode to check that.
It's interesting how it can feel like you change your opinion, but looking back on it, I still think that I would probably still put it there. Like it's a great fucking movie.
Yeah.
It really is.
And like to me, honestly, it's number 1, except for the fact that the sheer fucking greatness of The Shawshank Redemption.
Mm-hmm.
Like it's just like it's like Rocky. It just won't stay down in terms of like, you know, like it should lose. You know, nothing should beat The Shining in my mind. You know,
yeah.
I mean, I get the King complaints. I get people that are book purists, but for me, I don't know. It's great. And it stands out. But like, yeah, The Shawshank I'd put higher just because like, oh my God, that movie is just
so good.
It's perfect. I really think it's one of the more perfect films of all time. So in terms of looking at the film as an adaptation, did any of the casting choices stick out to you as strange or as good?
Danny was fantastic. Dick was great. Jack, I understand the complaints about Jack, but for what Kubrick was doing, Jack's perfect.
Yeah.
I mean, I've heard, you know, I've read briefly he considered Harrison Ford or Robert De Niro. There's one other one that I'm forgetting.
Yeah. Yeah, I remember De Niro, Harrison Ford, Robin Williams.
Robin Williams was the third one. I remember reading that and going, none of those fit as well as Jack Nicholson for what Kubrick was doing.
Yeah.
If you're going to do Descent into Madness, there's different actors you could do. But for Jack Nicholson's performance, it's timeless. It's insanity personified. I mean, just look at that mug on the screen.
Yeah.
Like it's just insanity.
Yeah.
sheer insanity. And you're not going to find anyone better to do that than Jack Nicholson.
Yeah. So Danny's an interesting story because I forget the kid's name is Danny as well. The actor, he never acted again. I believe he teaches college now. He's a college
Danny
teacher.
Lloyd.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. best bartender from Timbuktu to Portland, Maine or Portland, Oregon. Yeah. So, he actually was discovered, they basically did kind of a crazy, kind of like John Connor later on with Terminator 2, where they basically just looked through thousands of kids nationwide, actors and not. He had never acted before. His parents put him up for the role. I think he was out of Chicago, I think, something like that. So, yeah, just kind of an interesting story on that. Because, I mean, when you watch the movie, I would guess that he was an actor in some way. But turns out not. I read some, I've been immersing myself in a lot of Kubrick recently, both for this podcast and just because Kubrick's fucking fascinating. And he mentioned Jack Nicholson in one interview I saw where somebody asked him about it, casting different whatever, and they asked about Jack Nicholson. And he said that, in his opinion, Jack's one of the most talented actors out there. And he said that he basically equated him to some of the greats of the golden age of Hollywood, going back to some of those guys like Clark Gable and like that golden era.
Yeah.
And he said that Jack is one of the only guys, in Kubrick's opinion, that matches that kind of like greatness in acting as those guys from the previous. So that's kind of interesting. What about Wendy? She's probably one of the most changed from the book to the movie. Did that ever?
It rubbed me wrong from the first time I saw the movie.
Okay.
And I hadn't even read the book.
Yeah.
There was something about her that just rubbed me wrong. And it obviously came out when I read the book, like,
yeah,
oh, okay, she's supposed to be blonde, she's supposed to be tough, she's supposed to be, like,
yeah,
ready to kick his ass and everything like that.
Yeah.
Not frail, like Kubrick's version.
Yeah.
But at the same time, that's kind of different than the time period, you know?
Yeah.
I remember the part of the book where Jack's talking about his own mother being beaten by his father. And, like, standing up for him in the hospital and everything like that.
Yeah.
You know, that's very typical of that era.
Time period,
when
yeah.
When Jack the character, not Jack Nicholson, Jack the character was a boy. And Wendy fits the generation after that in the book.
Yeah.
You know? I'll leave your ass. You touch him again, I'll leave your ass. I'll kill you. You know, that kind
of
thing.
You're actually circling around. And another interesting thing I found in those interviews, they asked about Shelley Duvall as Wendy. And Kubrick said he did not like King's, character choice for Wendy.
Yeah.
Because he said for a alcoholic anger guy that beats the kid, he said a woman that Shelley Duvall would play would be the type of woman that would stay with Jack.
Mm-hmm.
He says the one that King wrote would have been gone years ago.
See, that's the thing.
I can't fault that. I'm the same as you. Like,
I get it.
Until I heard that interview, and that I only read that over the last last week. Once I read that, it was kind of like this moment of revelation for me. Where I was like, you know, I've never thought of it that way. But yeah, if you kind of have that, the one that was a cheerleader in high school, she's strong willed, she's smart, mm-hmm. she's blonde, like whatever, like that. I don't see that. I mean, I know King wrote it different, and King has the benefit of writing a book. He can explain internal thoughts stuff,
which
Kubrick
which
can't.
Did.
Kubrick can't. He has to just what you see or what's portrayed there. Like, so for him, it's easier to go, Shelley Duvall, this is the kind of woman that she's gonna kind of be the pushover and mm-hmm. stay with Jack. So it's interesting.
I get it, but to a point, Kubrick's logic is flawed. I mean, there's strong women out there that, or strong men and women that stay in abusive relationships. It's not just weak ones that do. And that's where I have a problem with that frame of thinking. And especially with King's logic behind it, she has nowhere else to go.
Yeah.
You know, it's not that she's, you know, a strong woman wouldn't stay. She would have left his ass a long time ago. No, it's a woman who's backed into a corner, has no other choice, is ready to leave him, like goes to have the conversation with him, and he says, wait.
Yeah.
I'm about to change. Wait for me.
Yeah.
I promise you things are going to change. And so for the sake of her son, for the sake of her love, because she loves him, she's hoping that he's true to his word. And he he was. I mean, let's be perfectly honest. Jack Torrance never took another drink in his life.
Yeah.
Real. There's a few imaginary margaritas that may have been down, but...
Now, do you think they're not real? I feel like there's a point that it becomes real.
I don't think...
It's like the Kubrick movie. I actually, one of my things here, I found a clickbaity YouTube video just over the last couple of weeks that popped up on my recommended, and it was basically the gist of it was explaining or trying to explain how Jack got out of the freezer. And I'm like, are these guys just, like, is there... I didn't click on it because I don't... Because fuck those kind of people. Like, I hate clickbait shit. But I'm like, are these guys just... basically then trying to go that the whole everything is Jack's imagination or it's all in his head.
Who strangled Danny then?
Yeah, no, I mean that too, but yeah. It's like, to me, it's like the unlocking of the bolt, like that's like one of those things where it's like that's where you telegraph yeah. the audience, like
this hotel's manifesting
this is real.
Itself
yeah.
in a physical sense.
Yeah, this is real. Like, there is no so I just, that kind of makes me like shake my head when I saw shit like that, because I'm just like, no, this is like, so for me, I'm the same. It's the same with the alcohol. Like, I feel like because that pushes Jack to bad places, I feel the hotel, using Danny as power, is able to manifest real alcohol. And that's more book side than movie side. It's kind of the same as the bolt being removed on the freezer. I just kind of assume that they're able to manifest.
Maybe later on, I gotta reread that part. I was kind of trying to hurry through. The inner part.
In terms of the book, I will say too, because Wendy smells gin when she finds him passed out.
Does she?
Yeah.
I don't remember. That's what I'm talking about. The part that I'm remembering is when Danny gets choked in 217.
Yeah.
And he goes up to the Colorado Lounge and says, line up the margaritas.
Yeah.
When she comes running in later, and when he runs to Jack, she's like expecting to smell. No, it's when he has his nightmare. She's expecting to smell booze and doesn't.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
So,
yeah.
So to me, that's where it kind of got ingrained in me. Oh, okay. The Overlook can't get him drunk.
Yeah.
It can make him feel like he's drunk. It can make him act like he's drunk, but it can't actually physically change that aspect.
Yeah.
But smelling the gin, I completely missed that. I don't know how I missed that.
Yeah. Yeah. So I'm of the belief that, yeah, the hotel can, at a certain point, and again, using Danny, you know, it's kind of like Dick, right? Dick tells Danny, like, it's all pictures in a book, because that's all it ever was before. But suddenly, when you've got an atomic bomb of fucking Danny here.
A nuclear power plant.
Yeah,
to
like,
change things.
Yeah, that changes everything. Suddenly now, you know, I just blanked on her fucking name. Room lady, 217.
Mrs. Macy?
Yeah. Like, suddenly she's not just a specter that's freaking people out, you know? Some fucking vile, wet spook that's just like sauntering the hall or like the room and like scaring fucking cleaning ladies. Like, no, now she's like grabbing fucking Danny and choking him out, you know, like jiggling the doorknob for fucking Jack. Like,
can
you know,
can we talk about that for a second? Why doesn't she kill him? Why doesn't Mrs. Macy kill Danny?
Because I don't know if they want him dead.
They want him dead by Jack's hand, because Jack's gonna kill him.
Yeah.
Why not just have Mrs. Macy finish him right then and there?
Maybe she can't. Maybe.
Because then it's Jack versus Wendy.
Well, maybe that they only have so much power, you know, in terms of like.
See, and that's back to what I was talking about with the alcohols. There's so much that they can do. Moving a bolt. It's kind of like ghostly, you know?
Yeah.
Move a bolt. Strangle marks is a little bit more than.
Yeah.
Normally would. But that goes into the book thing. Danny doesn't believe that they're real, but deep down he really does, and that's what gives them power to actually choke him.
Yeah.
If he believes, it's that what's that monster? You can't hurt me if I'm afraid of you. If I'm afraid of you, then you can kill me, but if I'm not afraid of you, you can't. What is that?
Freddy's a big one.
Freddy's the big one with fear. Yeah. I'm not afraid of you anymore, you know?
Yeah.
It's when there's fear that Freddy's more powerful.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. So, have you, I know, I don't know if I mentioned it to you. Have you heard of the Room 237 documentary?
Yeah.
Okay. Have you watched it?
No.
Okay. Is that something you're going to watch?
Maybe. Okay. Okay. Not today, but maybe.
If you ever do, you'll have to let me know. And for anyone listening too, I mean, if you guys in the chat or, you know, whatever, email, tweet, whatever, there's a lot of people who are into it, man. I had a lot of friends that are all into it that told me to watch it. I think I got about halfway in before I shut it off. It's just, to me, I can't get into it. So are you familiar with any of the, I mean, have you seen articles, YouTube videos? Like, a lot of the shit that's in that gets kind of disseminated out into different places. Have you heard any of the conspiracy mm-hmm. theories about it?
No.
About The Shining? Kubrick, anything? No?
No.
Okay, so, I mean, you've heard the conspiracy theory, at least, that Kubrick helped film the moon landing.
Yes.
That's as big as, like, Bigfoot when it comes to whatever. Okay, so there's people that believe that there's aspects of The Shining that are admissions of that. At one point, Danny's wearing an Apollo 11 sweater. So it's just one of those things.
Okay.
I mean, yeah, people really just latch on like one thing at one point. I mean, like, it's some of the shit, like I said, I only watched like half of it. Cause like it got to the point where I'm just like, dude, this is fucking like, I think it was Freud that said sometimes a cigar is just a cigar. And like, to me, like, I just feel like there's sometimes that people just go overboard. Like, I'm all about like finding deeper meanings, but like, you've got to accept sometimes that it's not always. I feel like with Kubrick, everyone's just like, oh, he was so meticulous, so every little thing there is like whatever. Like, one of the things is it's like about or some kind of speaking on the Native American Holocaust. It's you know, using the Indian burial ground that it's buried on, as well as one of the things that people link onto is like one of the brands of like crackers or something that's in the thing is a Native American branded whatever.
Okay.
So, like, one of them's it has something to do with the Holocaust. And, like, when you look into that, it gets into, because Jack's typewriter is a German typewriter.
What the hell?
I'm trying not to be, like, super negative, but, like, some of this stuff's very, like, some of it's very thin, I'm going to say. I'm trying to think of some of the others. There's one conspiracy that, when they're driving up to the Overlook, that Kubrick had his face, airbrushed into the clouds. Never okay. seen that. Personally, I've never seen that.
So wait. Okay, you're throwing me a curveball here. Room 237 is just a conspiracy theory.
It's basically
thing about Kubrick.
It's trying to find like all of the things that, because people have all these theories. Because again, everyone thinks of Kubrick and they think he's so into like everything. Because he's you've heard the stories about him in terms of how many takes he does. He's very...
That was something that I did hear about. I was going to bring it up. There's a story about... is it Dick Halloran, the actor that plays Dick? One time had to do over 100 shoots for one of his scenes. And then his next movie was directed by someone very down to earth. I can't remember who it was. And in his first scene, he did one take and he broke down crying because he didn't have to do multiple takes.
Yeah, probably sounds right. Yeah.
Yeah. I read about that. That was a while ago. And I'm that's from memory. I'm trying to remember who it was. I could probably look it up. But no, I do remember that they talked about Jack Nicholson is obviously the big one. Like, he would just be exhausted after shooting.
Yeah. Yeah, I'm trying to remember something, but it's just like something. Yeah, but like, to me, it's all very, it's all very thin to me. And like, again, there's part of me that just thinks that like, I don't know. If you ever watch it, let me know. I'd love to hear what your thoughts are. And listeners, if you guys have watched it, maybe you believe some of the stuff or buy into it. I'm totally for that. Like, everyone's different. But I kind of always, I don't know. I have a feeling that maybe Kubrick is more, and not just The Shining, but I think everything with him. I think people overanalyze his stuff a lot, and I don't know that it's justified. I think it's one of those things that he was reclusive, so he doesn't have as many interviews out there, so that perpetuates his stuff more. And then just the fact that he's connected to so many things like the moon landing and stuff that I just, whatever. One quote I wanted to pull from Kubrick that I found that I liked, he says, "A story of the supernatural cannot be taken apart and analyzed too closely. The ultimate test of its rationale is whether it's good enough to raise the hairs on the back of your neck. If you submit it to a complete logical and detailed analysis, it'll eventually appear absurd." So, kind of part of me that's like, I mean, I don't know. It's part of me just thinks that I don't think Kubrick's is like crazy deep as some people want to make him out to be. Mm-hmm. And then I think just that right there, I think is kind of a quote. Like, I just don't think that, I don't know that Kubrick would have wanted the kind of analysis that people are trying to put into this movie. But yeah, I wanted to at least mention it because I don't know, it's a thing, and it's a big part of the movie is the mystique around it for sure. Okay, so let's do you have any other thoughts on the movie?
No, I'm good.
I'm sorry. Did I favorite scene? I forgot to ask that question. I skipped that one because I jumped down to that YouTube portion. Favorite scene? Is there anything that jump out at you as like stuff you really love? Either the way it's shot. It could be the acting. Yeah. It could be anything. Just
I love every time Jack sits at the bar.
Yeah,
like Jack Nicholson, Jack Torrance. I mean, it doesn't matter. It's a great scene. When you realize that he's not just talking to himself. Because if I remember right, I'm trying to remember that scene now. Kubrick shoots it from behind the bar facing Nicholson.
Yeah.
And he's talking.
It'd be first person from Lloyd.
Yeah, he's talking. And then you finally get the shot and revealed that, holy fuck, there's actually someone standing there. That is one of those scenes that's like, you know, like there's a scene in a TV show that I have where someone's just had brain surgery and they're laying on the bed and they're talking and you're like, they're just having, you know, a side effect of the brain surgery that they supposedly had. And then it pans out and there's a creature on the ceiling and you're just like, the fuck, you know, like, ah, no, that's not okay.
Yeah.
That's kind of the thing for me with Kubrick. The other one is goddamn the first time Danny comes around the corner and the little girls are there.
Yeah.
That scene still gets me.
The Grady girls.
Yeah,
the everyone Grady says girls. Twins, but early in the movie, Ullman says they were, 8 and 10?
Yeah.
So, not twins, unless that was a long birthing process there, 2 years in labor for twins. That is an... just the way that shot, the Danny cruising.
Oh, yeah.
And everything about it. For me... I do love the bar scene a lot, but probably my absolute favorite, to be honest with you, and it's not even that crazy of a scene, but like, I love the room, I love the conversations gone, it's the fucking red bathroom with Grady and Jack after when he spills the drink on him and he brings him into the bathroom to clean him up. For one, every fucking bathroom in the world should look like that bathroom. I wish I had a picture of it for the slideshow, I should have grabbed it, but it is the most fucking glorious thing I have ever seen. It's magnificent. But the way that Jack Nicholson plays Jack when he realizes that the guy is saying that his name's Grady and he's like, have I seen you before?
Yeah.
No, sir. And he's like, I can't remember how he like approaches it, but he's like, you family man?
Yeah.
Grady. Where are they now? Like, just the way he plays that is so funny. And like, also, I mean, from the filmmaking side, what I love is that like, there's this whole idea of the rule of the 180 degree rule. And, like, if you and I are going face to face, there's a line between us, and the camera can go anywhere on the one side of that 180 degree line. But if it wants to jump, it has to do like a new establishing shot. You know, because like if we were filming us from one side, so where you're on the right side of the screen, I'm on the left side of the screen, you know, the camera's got to keep that going for the audience not to get confused.
Yeah.
Because if it was like having you on that side, but then it flipped for me, so we're suddenly like on the screen, we'd both be looking the same direction. Like the audience would be like, what the hell's going on? You know, like it confuses people. But that scene jumps all over that. It's fucking bouncing back and forth. Like it jumps that line repeatedly. And I'm like, Kubrick's a good enough director, he's doing it on purpose, and it makes you feel uneasy.
Yeah.
And it makes you just, there's something about it that's like,
yeah,
it keeps jumping from where you're looking back towards like the stalls, and then it'll like jump to where your stalls are behind you and you're looking out toward the door, and it just keeps doing that, and it's like,
stop it.
Yeah, it's like this, like it's hard to notice maybe unless you're like paying attention. First time I ever noticed it, I'd seen the movie dozens of times. And I realized what it was doing, and I was just, and ever since then, that's all I can focus on. But in the red bathroom, I love the conversation. I love the way that Jack Nicholson's playing it, because he's just like being cheeky. He's just like,
yeah,
you killed him. You chopped him into little pieces. And like, it's just, I fucking love it. It's one of my favorites. Is there anything about the movie that you're not totally into? Kind of the same question I asked with the book. Anything that jumps out at you? I think
that the ending's always got me. It does the review that we read earlier kind of talks about it. It is kind of jarring. Just we're done.
Yeah.
Like, okay. Like, wait. What, you know? What happens to Danny? What happens? Do they get down? Do they not? You know. And I get it. There's always there's movies that leave that, you know, ambiguity there for you to let you kind of decide for yourself what you think. There's no reason not to think that Wendy and Danny survived. I mean, they got into the little, like,
The snow cat.
I was going to say snowmobile, but that wasn't right.
Yeah, it's a snowmobile in the book and the series.
Mm-hmm.
It's not a contained snow cat, but in the movie, it's a snow cat.
Yeah. But it's just like, well, Dick brings up a snow cat in the miniseries.
I thought it was a snowmobile.
No, it's a snow cat in the miniseries. And the three of them fit in a cab when they drive away.
But in the book, it's a snowmobile.
Is it? Okay.
Because they get out of the house, but they don't have any winter clothes. So they have to go back to the shed where the rook mallets are at. And that's the point when Dick starts to get the thoughts in his head of, like, fuck these people. Like, take one of this mallets and fucking beat them, you know? And he's in there trying to get, like, horse blankets to, like, cover, because they're going to fucking die. Like, it's not
bad.
There's no cabin. They're going to be on the back of, like, a motorcycle, basically.
But aside from, I lost my train of thought.
Just the end being abrupt, is that?
Yeah, that's what it was. Yeah, the end was just kind of like, bah, Jack Nicholson frozen. The end.
Well, no, you do get the picture, too.
That's true, and I read something very interesting about that after watching the movie a while ago that I wanted to bring up. Apparently, Jack's posed in a very specific way.
Yeah.
Did you ever read about that? It's like a satanic thing.
Something, yeah. But
it came up on movie details on the movie subreddit. It's movie details.
I actually did find something in an interview with Kubrick talked about that a little bit as well.
Oh, really?
So they asked him, like, was that just like Jack Nicholson and extras? He says, no, it's actually a real picture from 1921. He's like, we just airbrushed Jack Nicholson onto one of the front guy, basically. So the because he's like,
oh, Jesus,
because he's like, we tried to do some extras. He's like, but there's nothing we could do to get the right look, the right, like, you know, costumes for people. We couldn't get the right lighting. He's like, there was just nothing we could do that it just wouldn't look right. So they found a real picture. So literally all that is that makes it different from a real picture that exists is a Jack Nicholson head on the guy. So now, do you interpret that as Jack got into the hotel and, like, that changed to Jack, or was that always Jack? Like, if they would have ran across that picture in the first day at the hotel, would that have been Jack's face that he's, like, always been there? Like, because that's, like, the two interpretations is, like, either, like, that picture kind of changed because Jack's now in there and it, like, kind of whatever, like, changed to him, or was it always him? And if, you know, Jack or Danny or Wendy had accidentally ran across that on day one, they would have seen their dad's and husband's face on there.
I think that it became Jack's inn.
That's what, yeah, that's more of the way I think too.
I found that post. It was on the movie details subreddit, and it says, in the final scene of The Shining 1980, when the camera zooms in on photo, Jack Torrance can be seen in the Baphomet pose that was used in religious satanic statues. So right hand up, left hand down, and then the top comment does a, here's the comparison to what it's supposed to be. So it's just interesting, especially finding out now that Kubrick just found a 1920s photo.
Yeah.
And airbrushed Nicholson's face onto a guy.
Yeah.
Because that means that's completely just coincidental.
Yeah.
Or was it? I'm going to do a conspiracy theory now for it. No.
In terms of me, the only thing I'm probably not into, and it's something I've always disliked about the movie, but then I found an interview during the course of these last couple of weeks that, like, Kubrick kind of explained it, he just does Dick dirty, man.
Oh yeah.
The whole trip from Miami to back to Sidewinder.
This bothered you back when I first watched it in high school.
And then he fucking gets axed, like, right away.
Yeah.
Oh, but I found an interview with Kubrick where he's just like, I was just trying to upset expectation. He's like, everything we had built and everything that anyone had ever seen before in previous movies would be that Dick's there to save the day. And he's like, so the best way to mess with an audience is to
kill him,
pull that rug out from under him. Like, you expect things to go one way, make it go the other way. And I'm like, okay.
All right.
It's the first time ever that I've been like, okay, I get it. But see, I love Dick Halloran. He's one of my favorite characters. And the actor, I'm blanking on his name at the moment, is amazing. So yeah, that's always probably been my least favorite. It's just that, like, he goes through all of that just to get a fucking axe. Mm-hmm. Although I will say, jump scare wise, it does a good job.
Yeah,
it's like it gets me like a quarter of the time, even though I know it's coming.
Scatman Crothers.
Yeah, that's
Crothers?
Right.
Yeah, Crothers.
Yeah, I think Crothers. Yeah. Okay, so jumping over to the miniseries now.
Yeah.
Alan had emailed those pictures of the Timberland Lodge.
Oh yeah, yeah.
And I was going to show them on a roundtable a ways back, and then I forgot. So I actually decided to just hold them for this episode. I don't have them all because he has a lot of pictures. So what I'll do is I'll put those all in the show notes. So I just have a couple here. So for one, I mean, just.
And this is what was used in the movie
for the exterior.
For the exterior. Okay.
Yeah. Because the interior is 100%, even actually some of the exterior, they built a full face of the hotel.
Yeah.
I'm thinking it's for that last scene of like Danny sliding down and stuff. That was all filmed like on a set.
Yeah.
So, which is crazy to think that they duplicated everything. But most of it's all set. But yeah, they did do the exterior there. And also it was interesting because in another interview, he mentioned where they filmed the helicopter stuff was actually in Montana.
Oh,
I can't remember. It was Glacier National Park. Does that sound right?
That's in Alaska, isn't it?
Is it? Maybe it's not Glacier. It's some sort of national park up in Montana. And Kubrick famously is terrified of flying, so he did not. He didn't even fly to America for that to be shot. Two, he definitely did not get in the fucking helicopter. So that was all filmed without him there. But he did mention it was in Montana. So I was like, oh, that's cool. So we've got the exterior in Oregon, you've got the drive up being filmed in Montana, and then almost the rest of the movie is filmed in England in Elstree Studios. So kind of cool.
Glacier National Park is Northern Montana, Canada, Idaho.
Okay. So yeah, that's where they filmed it.
Is where I just went to Google Maps and just zoomed out.
Oh. So, yeah, another one here, a little bit of a different angle on the hotel. Definitely iconic now. For sure. And then inside, this is where it varies from the original or from what we would think. It's definitely not the Overlook.
Oh, no. Yeah.
But still pretty cool.
Yeah, it's really cool.
This is an interesting one. The Barlow Room.
Wait, what?
Yeah. That's a fun thing to find.
I'm not going in there.
Now, you don't want any long pork?
No.
This is an interesting one. It looks like this is probably a shot of, I think it's Mount Hood, from the Timberland Lodge, the real exterior, of the Overlook. It's kind of cool because I don't think Kubrick really gives you much of a look out. Not, of course, because probably he can't because it's all on a set. But
yeah,
because in the book, they make a pretty big point about the view that you get. And I just know that in the movie, you don't actually really see the view. It's never something that you're exposed to. So it's kind of cool to see. And then now jumping to the miniseries. And this is the first time you've watched this, so I'll hit the intro stuff real quick. It's been well documented, even on our show. King was not happy with the Kubrick version, and he wanted to readapt it, this time for TV, and follow closer to the novel. They agreed, but there was actually a written agreement that he would stop bashing Kubrick.
Yes.
Which is hilarious.
I read up on the miniseries a lot. Because I had never seen it, and I generally try not to read like trivia about something.
Yeah,
if I haven't watched it.
Okay, so it came in three parts, totaling 4.5 hours. It was released April 27th through May 1st, 1997, which is when I first watched it, and I just watched it in the last couple of weeks for the first time since that those dates in 1997. It was actually directed by many time King adapter Mick Garris. Did you find that in your reading? Because he's obviously a big one for King. The ratings got pretty good ratings. Episode 1 got 19.8 million viewers. Episode 2 got 18.3 million. And episode 2 got 18.3 million. And episode 3 got 18.2 million. So a lot of viewers. It had a lot of success on that end. It was also overwhelmingly positive review wise when it came out. TV Guide gave it 10 out of 10. It was given good reviews by Variety and Entertainment Weekly. There were some negative reviews out there, but it was overwhelmingly positive. But history, it's kind of the opposite of the movie. History has been less kind to it, as if you look it up now, it's a 42% on Rotten Tomato. So it's kind of one of those where The Shining wasn't hot out of the gate, but then it's gotten better over time.
The word of
this
mouth.
Is kind of the opposite. It was really well loved at the time, but then as time's gone on, it's kind of worn away kind of some of its luster.
It's got a 6.1 out of 10 on IMDb.
Okay. So it won 2 Emmys for Outstanding Makeup and Outstanding Sound Editing. It was also nominated for Outstanding Miniseries, but it actually lost that award. So, yeah, that's kind of the tail of the tape, as it were. So jumping into the questions. So you watch it for the first time for this podcast. So just overall thoughts to start off.
Good. I mean, it definitely fits the book as an adaptation. More so than the Shining Kubrick film.
Yeah.
I gotta say,
how did you try to approach it? Did you try to approach it as like with the book in mind or like the Kubrick? Like how?
Well, I purposely waited to start the book until after I'd watched the miniseries because I didn't want to influence me.
Okay.
It's one of the reasons why I rushed through the book so fast to try to get it done is because I wanted to wait and have everything fresh in my mind, and I mistimed it a little bit. Had an unexpected trip that came up last weekend that was supposed to be a large chunk of my research. But I got through it, the miniseries, early this week and took some notes. I liked it. I enjoyed it thoroughly. I gotta say, Steven Weber, who plays Jack Torrance in the miniseries, if it wasn't for Jack Nicholson, I think we'd be calling it one of the greatest performance for King adaptations.
Yeah.
I think he gets overshadowed by Jack Nicholson, but I think he did a fantastic job.
Okay. That's awesome. Yeah, actually, that was into my next question. So that's good. For me, just in terms of, reaction, cause I haven't watched it in God, what is that now? 20 years would be 2017. So 23 years.
Yeah.
I, you know what's funny is I've actually bought it on DVD back in the day, but I remember just kind of being like, whatever, and I only opened it recently.
Yeah, we found that out.
It's, you know, whatever. Because, like, honestly, it's one of those ones that, like, I remember mostly enjoying it, but I remember not being happy with certain things. And I think because at that age, I don't think I was as into the book. The movie was certainly more of the big thing for me, so it was kind of tough. And I think I only viewed it through the paradigm of, like, I guess as a kid thinking, like, oh, this is just, they're just trying to remake the movie. Like, why? And so for everything, it was just judging it against the movie that I knew so well. And I don't think that was great for it. Also, the topiary, I remember in 97 just not being overly impressed with it, special effects-wise.
Yeah.
And I just kind of, like, it's like one of those things, like I've been like retroactively cringing about it since 97 a little bit every time I think about it, is I think about just that being the standout thing. But you know what's funny is that once I actually watched it here, I actually was like, this is not that bad. Like, it really was not that bad. Like, there was one scene that was a little bit, one element of the topiary at one point that it looks a little bit cheesy, but like, it's nowhere near Jumanji bad.
No.
So, but like in my head, I had like built it up over 23 years that it was going to be as bad as like Jumanji in terms of rewatching it. And it isn't. So I was actually very pleasantly surprised. And I was just like, holy shit, dude, I need to like keep this on a regular rotation. Cause this is like enjoyable. Overall, like it just as an adult being more of a fan of the book now as well, as you know, just Kubrick's film. So for me, it was kind of a huge revelation as well, and even though I'd seen it. And, like, it was funny because there's a few lines that, like, I remember still from 97. Like,
oh, really?
You're not getting my son. Like, the way that she says that.
Yeah.
Like, I remember that still from when it aired. Like, I don't know why. But it was just, like, when she said, I was like, the moment she started speaking, I knew, like, the cadence that she was going to hold through that line. And I was just like, that is so weird to remember something that weird that I haven't thought about in so many years. But, like,
yeah.
There was aspects of it that I remembered, it had some scary moments too. I was surprised that I was just like, for TV, I was just expecting it to be kind of, But again, I mean, Mick Garris did a great job in The Stand. He scares me a couple times with the corn, usually with Mr. Flagg. So I shouldn't be surprised he's a good director, even with his hands tied being on network television. So, but then jumping into Steven Weber as well. So, yeah, I'm glad because I was like, I wanted your thoughts. And then like Steven Weber is my second question, because like that's the next thing I was like wondering about. I was like, what'd you think of his performance? Are you familiar with him at all?
I know that he played in Wings. I read that in the trivia.
Okay. Are you familiar with Wings at all?
No.
Okay. So I watched the fuck out of that show when I was younger. Yeah, dude. So like for me, like I knew full well, like who he was. I'm like, oh, that's the dude from Wings. That's the younger brother. So like, you know, it's a show that had Betty White was in it. For God's sake. So like,
what, I mean, it's, that doesn't tell me anything. Betty White's been alive for like 3,000 years.
That's true. But I mean, in terms of like, what she's been involved with or whatever, but it's just basically like, I think it's like set somewhere up in New England, and it's just like this small little airport. They have a couple twin jet, you know, like prop things, and then like him and his brother are the two pilots. Betty White's like the lady at the desk that like calls out flights, and it's kind of like your average sitcom. Like you just got all these weird characters. One of them's like the taxi driver and stuff.
Okay,
like
okay.
One of the dudes is the guy from fucking Tombstone. That's you're seeing double. You're probably seeing two right now.
Yeah. That I got two guns, one for each of you.
That dipshit's from Wings. Like when I watch Tombstone, I can't watch that without going, "Oh, the guy from Wings." Like that's it for me. So I have that context. I assumed you hadn't, because I don't think it's like it's.
No,
it was probably before you would have
heard of it. Have no desire to ever go back and watch it.
Yeah. So I had that context that I figured you, and I was sure that you may not know Steven Weber. So one other tidbit though is you do know his voice though.
I do?
You do.
From what?
He has done some audiobooks over the years.
Has he?
Many actually. Dean Koontz, he's done some Tom Clancy. He's done one that I know you've listened to a number of times. One titled It.
Holy shit, really?
Yes, and he also did one of the stories in Let It Bleed very recently. So he is on the King thing. But yeah,
damn.
he is the voice that you've heard for probably 100 hours. reading It, because that's like what? Like how many hours is It? I forget.
It is 44 hours and 50, so 45 hours.
Yeah, so I'm pretty sure you've at least listened to it three times. So yeah, over you've heard his voice for over 100 hours.
That's him?
So now to like connect, I knew I'd get kind of a reaction out of you with that, because yeah, I was like, oh cool, it's It. I knew it was one of them. And actually, when I started The Shining this time, I was misremembering. I was thinking that he also did The Shining. So I was expecting him, and then the other this voice started in this book. I'm like, what the hell? And I looked at it and saw the name. I'm like, oh, shit, somebody else. I'm like,
yeah.
And I looked it up, and I'm like, oh, yeah, it's It that he does. But, yeah. And it was actually funny because he was Steven Weber wasn't offered the part. The guy that played his brother on Wings was.
Yeah.
And he turned it down and said, you should give it to Steven Weber. So that's pretty cool. And, yeah, so I'm glad you enjoyed his performance, because I was actually – blown away by it. I mean, I don't know that I was as like much into like judging acting when I was god what 97 I was fuck
12
would have, going, no 11, I would have been 11
11 yeah. Going on 12
would have been 11, because it came out in the spring, so yeah. I was 11, so I mean I hadn't read the book yet. I'd only seen the movie, like, you know, like whatever. But yeah, looking back on it, and in a lot of ways, I'll even say it, man, I think Steven Weber, I'd put him against Jack Nicholson. Because I think his performance has a lot more to it, layers-wise, than Jack Nicholson.
Well, that's what I was bringing up earlier, and this is kind of why I was kind of poo-pooing the book a little bit. Not the book, the movie a little bit, is because listening to the audiobook and watching the miniseries for the first time, King's story isn't about a psychotic father taking his abused family to a hotel and abusing them and then trying to murder them.
Yeah.
It's a father who's a human being trying to overcome a disease of alcoholism, a very serious disease, who's made some regrettable mistakes that his wife is deciding to stick with him.
Yeah.
That's two very different stories, two very different characters.
And very personal for King. That's why I've always been okay with his hatred of Kubrick's movie, because it's very personal for him.
And I get it, too, especially with, you know, like you're saying, it's how personal it is with King's battle with alcoholism and addiction as well. I think Steven's character arc through the series is definitely, definitely more deep than Jack Nicholson's. So, like, what you're saying, I wholeheartedly agree. What you're seeing
and
here
he
do, on
and
this,
he does it well. I think that's the thing, is like, he has more that's asked of him, and I believe that he fucking nails it. I think I think he hits a home run at every aspect of this thing. So, I can't say enough about him personally. So I'm really glad that you liked too, because I was like wondering, you know, I'm unsure. I mean, like, we haven't texted about this, nothing. Like, I've kept it completely. I wanted to be as blind as possible.
Yeah.
For your reaction, you know, I think I at one point checked to see, like, you know, you coming along in terms of watching, reading, like, whatever. But beyond that, we haven't talked, so I wasn't
since we decided to do this show.
Yeah, so I wasn't sure, like, what your reaction would be. So I'm glad that you liked it, but that you liked Steven's performance.
The only thing that I ever knew about this versus the movie that Tad told me years ago, and it stuck with me, was that because I read the book after watching the movie. And I'm like, holy shit, that's like a completely different story. And you're like, yeah, it is. They made a miniseries where it's a little bit more true to the book. Like, he doesn't try to, he does try to dump the boiler, and that's what ends up getting him killed. It does blow up in the miniseries. That's the only thing I knew going in. That's the only thing I knew.
Yeah.
When I went to go watch the miniseries. And it was a great series. I'll call it. It's a great series.
Yeah, I agree, man. I've given it some undeserved shade for 23 years now, and now I'm kicking myself for not cracking that open 10 years ago, whenever the fuck it was I bought it on DVD and watched it again. I'm ashamed. I really wish I would have sooner, because
I thoroughly enjoyed it.
And I think if I would have watched it sooner, I definitely would have leaned on you peer pressure wise to watch it before. So,
I think that's how the conversation went when you told me about the ending, is like, there's really not much to it aside from the ending being more true to the book, where Jack, you know, tries to save his family by going to try to dump the boiler.
Yeah. Because, again, I mean, I'd seen it at age 11 and hadn't watched it since. So it's like, I don't know. And the thing is to me, is like, even with some of the memories being that were ultimately incorrect, thinking that it was like not that great. Like, how can I watch the Tim Curry It or the Mick Garris Stand and be totally okay with those and overlook their little imperfections and not register that I would be able to do the same thing for this? I've actually been a little bit mad at myself for just holding out on this for so long. Like I said, I'm going to keep it in my regular rotation now, man. Like, I will revisit this. It was really, really great to watch. What about Rebecca De Mornay as Wendy?
She was good.
I can't think of her except for there's a one point at Simpsons. I can't remember what, but it's like one of the things on TV. And I think it's like, maybe it's like Bart when he's in the mafia. And it's like, I think Rebecca De Mornay is playing like Edna Krabappel or something like that.
Oh, God.
So that name, like, all I could think of is like the Simpsons voice and Rebecca De Mornay is Edna Krabappel or something like that. But sorry, what did you think of her?
I liked her. Of the three Torrances, I think she was my least favorite performance wise.
Okay.
I thought she was good, but not, you know, great, you know?
Yeah. Yeah. Okay. I mean, I enjoyed it for sure. I thought she did good for sure, but it's definitely a different beast really. But yeah, I think that she's easily overshadowed by, Mr. Weber. Playing Jack,
or even for me, Danny.
Yeah, Cortland Mee. That was my next question.
He was really good.
So, you liked him?
I really did.
Okay, and he's I think he did a good job, and definitely had a lot that he had to do. So, how did you feel about the visualized Tony?
Oh,
because that was an interesting choice, and ultimately that it pays off at the end.
Mm-hmm.
Like, what did you think about that?
It was interesting. To see it done that way. I mean, if I'm going to be perfectly honest, that was more horrible looking than the topiary.
It was. That was probably more cringeworthy.
The floating, you know, Peter Pan pose, feet tucked behind him.
Yeah,
just
where it's like easily, you can tell it's like, not even, I don't know if it's green screen or what, but it's just, it just doesn't look real. Like, see, and things like that, total side tangent, that's the shit where I'm like, people want to tell me that CG is bad and that the shit from the old days is better. Fuck you, man. watch that and tell me that CG wouldn't have been better. So sorry, that's a side tangent. Yeah, but it's a perfect example. But so what beyond the special effects though, did you like the idea of using having a visual Tony versus just having the kid doing the creepy voice and the finger?
I think it was fine. It didn't take anything away from it or anything like that. I think it helped in one scene. I think it really helped in the 217 scene where he tries to go in the first time, because in the miniseries he tries to go in twice.
Yeah.
And Jack catches him putting the key back, you know?
Yeah.
And then he actually goes in later. Him popping up and scaring the shit out of Danny got me.
Yeah.
That's like one of the only times in the miniseries, to be perfectly honest, that got me.
Yeah.
Like flat out, like Jesus Christ, you know?
Yeah.
Because you don't expect it. You don't only not expect it from the hallway. Like you're expecting it from the doorway. But
yeah.
You also don't expect it from him.
Yeah. Yeah.
So.
Yeah. Miss Maisie got me in the miniseries too. But yeah, that's definitely a good one too.
Dude. They got away with a lot of stuff back then.
I know. I was like, because that's where I was just like, you know, it's TV, so there's just like certain things they're not going to be able to do. But it's like, so I was watching that, I was like, good Lord, man.
Steven Weber at the end had more blood on him than some movies back then that were rated R.
Yeah.
Like he was like blood coming out of the mouth, blood all over the face from where he got hit in the head by the ball.
Yeah, and this is like this is network television too. This isn't even cable. This is
97 ABC. Yeah. Like God
this
damn.
Is something that little Peter could have turned his TV on and seen this.
Yeah,
one night,
my mom would have lost her mind.
Oh, what about the payoff at the end? Like, did you?
I love the.
Because does the book actually pay that off? At one point, the doctor's like, you got to know where that's coming from. But I don't know that the book ever pays that off. Like, or it never gives you a good enough reveal that his middle name's Anthony. Mm-mm. Like, to enough to where it pays itself. I feel like King kind of like throws out the setup, but then never gives you the payoff. And at least the series like gave you that payoff of like, oh, look.
I see what you're talking about. I thought you were talking about like the ending. Like,
oh, no. That's where I
constitute the ending.
The full-on epilogue. Like, yeah. Where like the graduation and stuff.
I love seeing... I love it, but to a point, it kind of, you know, it's like, knowing Dr. Sleep, Danny was troubled afterwards. That gave the impression that Danny's going to be perfectly fine and everything's hunky-dory and there's his dad and his dad loves him. And oh, that's great.
I still think it fits with Dr. Sleep, though. Like, ultimately, like, it's getting into adulthood is when troubles
that's
are going
to graduation.
Strike you, right?
That's, you know.
But that's entering adulthood. Like, a lot of the shit that...
If I remember right, again, we're not supposed to talk about Dr. Sleep, but if I remember right, he started drinking in high school.
Yeah.
So graduating with honors.
Yeah.
You know.
But you can't fault the series.
No, I can't. But
Dr. Sleep is, what, 15 years in the future or something
true.
Like that?
It's true. No, you're right. But for me, that's where it's kind of like, oh, there was no lasting effect from this. Like, there's no scarring. There's no... They didn't give us that impression. He's... I'm good. Dick's good. Mom's good, you know?
Yeah. I think it's good because, and I think that what the movie didn't, was that it really played the fact that Jack was never bad.
No.
You know, Jack became possessed. Like, it wasn't Jack. And the book does that, too. That's not your father. Like, that's the hotel, basically.
Yeah.
It's a mask.
You were saying it earlier. Danny knew.
Yeah.
Danny knew. You know?
Yeah. And so, like, for me, like, seeing the, okay, cool, there he is, graduating. But then, like, for him to see his dad, too, I thought that was kind of.
I get that. No, that's
I like
really,
that.
That's, yeah.
I like that.
It just didn't do it for me as much as I thought it would.
Yeah. Now, the graduation portion or the stuff with his dad?
The graduation portion didn't. The stuff with his dad, I could have very easily seen that a different way. I would have been much better off with it.
Yeah.
But the graduation thing just was like. Okay.
Yeah,
like,
and then ultimately, the very last thing we see...
is the Overlook being rebuilt.
Being rebuilt.
Yeah.
So I actually don't know how I feel about that, because it's just like, really? I mean, it's horror movies, so you have to, right? Like, in a way. Like, that's like horror 101. Like, you've got to do something to establish that, like, the evil is not truly gone or whatever. But, like, there was part of me that's like, really? whatever. So King had his cameo as the band leader. Mm-hmm. You notice that? I mean,
King, there was a lot of cameos.
King looks different now than he did back then. Yeah. I was just like, I
had to pause it. I was like, wait.
Yeah.
Wait. I paused it and I looked up Stephen King cameo miniseries. I'm like, that is him.
It is him, yeah. Okay, see? So I'm not wrong, because, I was just like, I kind of remembered he had a cameo somewhere, and I'm like, where is it again? And then when the band leader finds it, I'm like, I think that's him. I'm like, I think that's him. And I'm like, yes, it is. Okay.
That was 23 years ago.
Yeah, he's much, much different now. Of course, also Sam Raimi, you probably saw if you saw the trivia. I love that.
Frank Darabont.
Yeah, I actually missed his, but
I still don't know who it is. I
know what he looks like,
I
too.
I watched it.
But I think I read that trivia, literally, 10 minutes after I passed that scene. Oh. So I was just like, I'm not going back.
I read the trivia after watching it, and I'm like,
oh, yeah.
I'm drawing a blank here. What's he talking about?
Yeah. Lloyd from The Stand is the voice of Jack's dad.
Oh, yeah.
I was going to say, if you were looking at the trivia, if you didn't click on the name, the actor's name probably doesn't jump out to you. But it's Lloyd from The Stand. So that's a fun little cross-pollination of Mick Garris's 90s King stuff. The one thing, and I think I mentioned this earlier, remember the topiaries, but I had a lot less of a problem with them this time than I did in 97. I think it was just one of those things, in 97, I mean, you're talking, I'm only a couple years removed from Terminator 2,
Jurassic
Park, some of the greatest, special
CG,
effects
special
movies
effects
of all time.
Yeah.
You know, I'm only a few months away from, the remastered Star Wars 97 releases, I was a spoiled kid when it came to special effects, so, when it came to, whatever. Right now I'd say that 1933 King Kong is the absolute best, and I don't even like any of the others. That's just give me the original. But as a kid, I wouldn't have said that. I don't know. Oh no, he looks
terrible.
He looks stupid.
Well, you also have to remember 97 was also Titanic.
Yeah. Later in the year though. So that
was I thought it was a summer blockbuster.
It was Christmas. Oh. No. Because that one was one of those ones where it ran into the next year for months, number one in the box office.
Gotcha.
So. Yeah,
because they had nothing else.
It's the only time I ever went to a movie theater and saw people. They oversold so much, people are sitting in the aisles on the ground.
Damn.
Because I remember, my grandparents, too, and that's probably the last time they were in a movie theater. But I remember that, because even then as a kid, I was like, you guys don't go to movies, but they went with us. And I remember my grandpa being like, that's kind of a fire hazard. They sold it out that much. They were how wide aisles they have at theaters? Three or four people on each step just sitting.
That's bizarre.
That's crazy. I've never seen anything like that since. That's crazy.
Well, especially nowadays, that won't happen with the side seating and everything.
Yeah, so. Yeah. Another addition was the fire hose. What did you think of that?
The fire hose was good.
Yeah.
I liked it.
So I found a thing that EW reported that cost $30,000 to make that special effect for those two scenes.
I read that too. Yeah.
Yeah. That's, I thought it was worth it. Yeah. Cause I think that is creepy. I actually remember that being, something that kind of creeped me out as a kid, as well, watching it when I
see, that's the kind of thing that used to be me as a kid. I lived, with my parents, obviously when I was a kid, and my basement had, I think I told this story before, had the light switches at the top and bottom of the stairs, and the basement wasn't finished. So creepy vibes, because just shit piled everywhere, and everything like that. And I don't know why, but for the longest time, it was better to turn the light off at the bottom and book it up the stairs as fast as I could, because then I couldn't see if something was behind me. But if I left the light on, I'd have to pause at the top of the stairs, which, of course, then I would look back, and if I saw something come around the corner, or a hand reaching around the corner, or a claw reaching around the corner, or a paw, or anything.
Yeah.
That I would lose my mind, So it's kind of along those lines kind of thing. It's
That reminds me of 217 with Jack. He doesn't look, because he knows if he sees the doorknob jiggling, that he would lose his mind.
Yeah.
And they did that in this miniseries, too. Steven Weber shuts his eyes. Nope. So that was good. I had to take note of the fact that it's kind of funny that we're being more true to the book, but Grady doesn't have a family in this series, and now Roke is no longer Roke, but it's fucking Colorado Croquet or some shit like that. That made me laugh, where I was just because it was funny, because it's okay, cool, Kubrick, I know Kubrick's movie, I know there's differences, but now that it's like, this is, and it's even being called Stephen King's The Shining, like, if you Google that, you're going to get the series. You're not going to get the book, you're going to get the series, because this, that's how they title it, because it's like, this is Stephen King's version. It's like, so you're going to say it's his version, but then, King, you're going to change shit on us? Like, no. Yeah. Like, Grady doesn't have kids now, he's just a single dude that lost his mind and shot himself? Like,
with
okay.
a shotgun? Okay.
Also,
well, part of me wonders if that maybe got axed, pun intended, for TV, because
I honestly I don't think they would have shown it, but it's just one of those things you could because they don't, you don't see the girls in the book either. It's just a matter of changing the backstory.
Yeah,
I honest to God think, dude, it's King being a prick and taking them out because they're so iconic in Kubrick's movie.
Honest
to God believe that might be him just being a prick. Where it's like, oh yeah, Grady, he's just a single guy, we thought he'd be all right. So much like the 90s It and The Stand, did you notice any of the shooting style or even like certain aspects of the acting that jumped out at you that felt uncinematic? Because like that happens to me with The Stand, and that happens to me with It, where it just feels made for TV. And a lot of times it's like, for me, it's like lighting and it's the camera, because they're not doing like 24 frames per second.
Oh, the lighting was horrible in the miniseries.
Yeah.
It felt like we both did stage plays. You on the backside with lighting and curtain, you know, the tech side, me with a lot of acting. Dude, the lighting felt like a theater production.
Yeah.
Like, Wendy falls down at one point when Jack swings at her, I think, the first time. Like, actual full-blown, like, that could have killed her if it had connected with her face.
Yeah.
Falls down and there's a boop spotlight that pops up on her. It's like, God damn it, guys. Come on.
Yeah, there's, it's just, again, it's one of those made-for-TV things that, yeah, I just, it jumped out at me a few times, but yeah. So you're saying it also jumped out at you.
The lighting in certain scenes was very, very poorly done.
I think there was some cheesy dialogue too. There was a few times where I don't know if it was necessarily how it was written or if how it was performed. Not the whole thing, but there were certain times where I'm just like, oh, that was cheese ball.
Yeah,
like that wasn't good.
Yeah. One thing that jumped out at me was the what was it? The sultry scene where she comes up and. Service to the front, and then the scene that. I was like, damn, that's... Because you could tell where the commercial breaks are.
Yeah.
You know, and I was like, damn, this is kind of going. And then, like, I read the trivia afterwards, and it's like, it was like 10 minutes, and it's unheard of for miniseries to have a scene be that long.
Yeah.
And it wasn't until I read that I kind of looked back. I looked back at The Stand. I looked back at It. You know, just, like, going through in my head, and just like, oh, there really was no, like... You know, Bill's speech in It that goes for a few minutes after a fight or before a fight or anything
well,
like that.
Well, that's also a timing thing. Like, movies back in the old days were a lot more patient in terms of, like, letting a scene draw out. Like, think of, The Shining has a couple of examples.
Yeah.
Think of the Omen office scene. That's like that's almost a 10-minute scene.
Yeah.
The Godfather, when Michael gives his speech about killing the cop.
Mm-hmm.
Like, that's like, probably a 7-some-odd-minute scene. Like,
yeah.
Nowadays, movies aren't like that. You can't have scenes that long. Like, scenes, they move. It's not that it has to be, like, fucking ADHD, but you've got to move it. Like, a couple, 2-3 minutes. Like, you can't sit in a scene for 7, 8, 10 minutes. Like, and The Shining does that. So when you're saying that this, it's a timing thing, too. Like, I think somewhere in, like, the 80s, people started to, like, trim it down and keep scenes moving.
It would be interesting to see what the if you took a film today and compared it to a film like The Shining, what the average scene length was.
Yeah.
You know, take a good movie, take Avengers Endgame.
Yeah.
And compare the length of the scene. I think there is some times where it has to be a lengthier scene. And that's where well, that also draws into the question is, you know, like, especially with action movies, you got to make sure that you're in the same genre, because let's be perfectly honest.
Oh, totally.
The battle at Avengers Complex,
yeah.
You know, the end battle, is that one scene? Or do you go from the three of them walking down to the reveal of everyone?
That's a sequence. Scenes would be the smaller things, like Ant-Man under the water and stuff like that.
Peter Quill with Gamora.
Yeah.
That kind of
those are
Spider-Man
scenes.
Captain Marvel. And those are scenes within the sequence.
With the sequence is the big thing. Yeah. So in general, it'd be interesting to look at, but yeah, you'd want to keep it within the same genre. But yeah, horror movies are definitely one too, where you don't expect huge long scenes. I mean, but again, time's different. Look at the original opening scene for the original Halloween. How long did that go? That's got to be a 5 to 7 minute scene.
Well, it's something that changed.
And it's all in one shot too.
It's something that changed with movies. And I wanted to, I actually wanted to ask you this off mic one time, and I always forget about it. Dude, when did movies change from having credits in front to credits in back? Now you get the...
Star Wars is the big one.
Now you get the... Well, they have no credits at all.
Yeah.
But now they, nowadays you'll have the, you know, starring Ted Winter, Peter Steele, directed by Ted Winter, written by Peter Steele. And then it's all of a sudden the Ted and Peter movie. And then you're into the movie. And then it wasn't until the end credits that you get Ted Winter played by.
Yeah.
Peter Steele played by.
I watched Ben-Hur. And like the whole credit sequence, everything.
Oh yeah,
everything.
All the way down to the one guy who ran and got me a cup of coffee one time. You know, like,
it was a slow progression, but yeah, it's crazy.
It's
to
just
watch
interesting
old movies.
To see that. But then, what movie was it that did that recently? Where they did the credits at the beginning and there was no credits at the end.
I'm not sure.
There was one that did that recently because I pointed it out to you after we walked out of it. I can't remember what it was. Or maybe we talked about it after you showed me it.
All righty.
Anyway, sorry.
No, do you have any other thoughts on the miniseries?
No.
I
had two things. The Stanley Hotel. That's the original hotel that King stayed in.
Yeah.
With his wife, the end of season, all that kind of thing.
Yeah.
Just wanted to make sure that we talked about that.
Yeah, because... I've got some in the global topic about that.
Did you?
But yes, that's true. I actually should have mentioned it in this portion that... This was actually filmed at the Stanley Hotel, which is where King was inspired, mm-hmm. which is the one that's in Colorado, Estes yes. Park, Colorado, room 217.
Where they stayed.
I was actually looking.
They were the only guests towards the end of the season. They were the only guests in this big hotel.
Yeah.
That.
And that's where. Yeah. For
yeah.
I'm going to make a trip, man. One of these days I'm going to make a trip there. I think last time I looked, which was probably 15 years ago, I don't know how it is now, but in the old days you had to reserve 217 like at least a year in advance. So I don't know how far in advance you have to go now, but I would definitely want room 217. I mean,
oh, of course. It's of course.
For posterity, if nothing else. What else did you have? You said you had two things.
The other one was, did you catch what song Jack turned on when he went into the party?
No.
It's a very famous song for the King universe.
No, I didn't.
Glenn Miller, In the Mood.
Oh, yeah?
11-22-63.
Yeah, right? Yeah, that is true. That is true.
That one instantly jumped out to me, and I'm like, wait a minute, is that...
But see, you've reread.
I've reread 11-22-63 lot.
Yeah.
I really enjoyed that book, and they even play it at the end of the audiobook.
Yeah.
So
that too, yeah.
So I was just wondering if you caught that, but yeah, absolutely. It's apparently a thing for King that song. So
yeah. And also, I kind of already mentioned now that I'm keeping a regular rotation. What about you? Now that you've watched it, is this one that you would revisit, or are you kind of one and done with it?
No, I think I'll revisit it. I mean, I don't revisit the Shining movie that often.
Yeah.
But I could definitely see...
Would it be in the same realm as like an It or The Stand where it's like, yeah, you've got to have a commitment of 4 to 6 hours, mm-hmm. but you do it every so often because it's worth a watch. Like,
I don't rewatch either one of those very regularly.
Really?
Not because I don't enjoy them.
It's a big commitment for time.
It is a big commitment. I'm not going to lie, dude. It's been rough watching movies recently.
Yeah.
Even just a couple hours.
It's everyone where it's like, oh, I don't have time for a 2-hour movie. Then they watch 9 episodes of a TV show and go,
the problem is that I don't have a show right now. So it's like, I could throw on a movie, but I mean, I'm looking for, we've talked about this. We've done this for years. I'm looking for something while I'm eating or something, you know.
Yeah.
I'm not playing a game or doing something with my daughter and my wife, you know. I'm looking for something just to fill like 20-30 minutes.
Yeah,
you know, part of me now that it's been fixed, part of me wants to go back and watch some more Simpsons.
Yeah, that's
true. I've only ever watched, you know, the little bit that you've lent me, or
yeah,
the little bit that I caught on FX Now and everything.
Yeah, well, that's a good transition as we move to the spoof. So this is the opening segment of the 5th Halloween special, which is sometimes called the Treehouse of Horrors. Which means it was the 6th season of The Simpsons.
Yeah.
Aired on October 30th, 1994, at 11.6 million viewers. EW has ranked this the ninth best episode of the entire series. EW has also pointed out, quote, a parody with such detail and comic timing that it ranks that it ranks with some of the greatest spoofs of all time.
Oh yeah,
which that's
high praise. Monty Python and the Holy Grail, Airplane,
yeah, Naked Gun. I mean, all the Mel Brooks stuff.
Oh yeah,
all of Mel Brooks, everything. IGN called The Shining the best Halloween special segment in the entire run of the show.
Yeah.
Vulture ranked it as the best segment for any Halloween episode and says, quote, when you can't think of the original without also thinking of the spoof, that's The Shining and The Shining. Easily the best Treehouse segment of all time. So just some surrounding data, just like we did with the other stuff, right? Very well received, very well rated. I think Beverly Hills 90210 was the only thing rated higher for Fox that week or whatever. So second highest rated show for the week. So big one. I mean, in terms of this, I wasn't going to like break down too much or have questions. I just want to at least point out a couple of my favorite jokes. I don't know if you,
I have two.
Okay. Go ahead.
Give me the bat. Give me the bat. Give me the bat. And then he looks over at himself and falls down the stairs.
Dude, I watched it today. Just eating. As a matter of fact, I was like, I'm grabbing some lunch.
Yeah.
You know, doing final prep. And I was just like, oh, I need something to watch. I'm like,
The Shining,
of course. So, yeah, and that
one,
dude, gut laugh every
single time.
Yeah.
The other one is the end. TV, family, come watch, bask in its warm glow, or whatever he says, and then it's like, what does it change to?
Yeah, it changes.
The show ends and something comes on, and it's Urge to Kill rising.
Yeah. Oh, man, yeah.
I can't, I'm frozen.
So for me, the ones that get me every time, I mean, the whole thing does, but the ones that really stand out to me is Burns. Strange, the blood usually gets off on the second floor. That kills me. Also, this is one that I think sneaks by people. After Willie takes the axe in the back, Marge goes, oh, my, I hope that rug was scotch guarded.
Scott.
That's I love that. And also, when Marge, my husband's on a murderous rampage, over, and Wiggum's like, thank God that's over. I was worried there for a second. That just fucking kills me, dude. It's I mean, I reference it all the time, you know, like the whole, no time between 4 and 5. That's Willie time. I say that all the time.
Yeah.
Like it's
the one that my wife has never had never seen The Shining before me. And even before I introduced her to it, because she wasn't huge on horror films.
Yeah.
Until after
she
I showed
knew
her,
The Shining.
Until I actually showed her good one. The Shining? Hey, babe, did you ever want to watch The Shining? Didn't you mean The Shitty? Shh. Want to get sued?
Yeah, that's like the classic joke. Also, I love the his writing will be a window into his thoughts. Feeling fine. Oh, that's a relief. All the stuff all over the walls. Yeah, it's so good, dude. Yeah, it's great.
It's good.
I love
it's
it.
Really, it's really great.
Huge Simpsons fan. And if anyone hasn't seen it for some reason, definitely check it out. It's... Even just if you have Disney Plus, just jump on and watch it. It's like, what, 10 minutes? Not even 10 minutes, probably.
A third of a 25-minute episode.
Yeah,
so.
Dude, and it's the first one. So it's a first part of that, too, so you don't even have to watch the other two. It's brilliant. It's absolutely brilliant. The Simpsons is certainly at the high mark during that time period. Okay, so now moving over to the global questions I had. So which version do you prefer, all things considered, now that you've seen them both? Like,
the
if
book.
It comes down to the... Oh, okay. I guess if you're talking just the visual, though.
Oh.
I know that's a hard one.
I'd still probably go with the movie.
Yeah. Just, it's...
It's... Okay.
On its own, it stands as one of the greatest movies of all time.
Let's be perfectly honest. As great as the miniseries is, as honest and true to the book as it is, it's not scary. It's just not.
Yeah.
It's just not scary. The Shining with Jack Nicholson is terrifying.
Yeah.
Okay. I spent 4 days. We drove up Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, drove home today from Idaho. About 3.5 hours that way. Okay. We were up in the fucking mountains. Like, I didn't have cell signal. Like, I was lucky they had Wi-Fi so that I could still do stuff up there.
Yeah.
I got to be perfectly honest with you. Watching part of The Shining, because I finished it up there. I started it down here, finished it up there. watching part of The Shining, even in that aspect of it, there was a house across the street from us, but it was across a dirt road, down a driveway, 200 yards.
There's probably weasels out there.
To a house, 200 wheels. Yeah, we'll call it that.
No, weasels.
Weasel. Oh, there was weasels. We yes. saw weasels. I'm not kidding.
Yeah.
We saw weasels.
Can't trust them, man.
No, you can't. But there was no corn, so I was okay. But
the rats are heathens.
But seriously, in that isolated, even in that isolated, I was with my family. So my two sisters, their spouses, their kids.
Parents and stuff.
My parents,
yeah.
My wife and daughter. Even in that instance, it's like, we did family photos up there. And the woman we were talking to had to, of course, tell me on the first full day there, on Thursday morning when we did pictures, oh, yeah, the winters up here are pretty harsh. Like, you get snowed in sometimes. You can't leave for a few days. And I'm just like, I'm listening to The Shining, like, son of a bitch. And thank God it was June.
Yes.
Otherwise, I'd be like, family, get in the car. We're going home.
No, we're out.
Like, we're yeah. up. We're up. We're up in the Rockies. You know, we're yeah. we're up there. We're not up there, like, overlooked, but we're up there. So, for me, The Shining, the movie, is still terrifying.
Yeah.
The series is something I'm going to watch with my wife to enjoy it.
Yeah.
And my daughter will be introduced to The Shining first through the series, then the movie, if she ever gets to watching horror. Because, Tad, I got to break a bad news to you, man. I don't think the kid's going to like horror movies.
There's only one way to find out, sir.
We were up there. We went into a cave. And when we got out of the cave, we were walking back to the cars. And we're like, hey, what'd you think of the cave? That was scary. Terrifying, horrifying. I didn't like it. I'm like, I don't think she's gonna like horror movies.
Yeah, yeah. So in terms of for me, yeah, it's gonna be the movie. I do. I have a new love for the series, but the movie's tops for me. Also, just thinking about you're saying getting snowed in, it reminded me one of my favorite things from The Shining, the movie, is that he's like, I know about cannibalism, I heard about it on TV. That's right, he heard about it on the television. Just the way that Jack Nicholson plays that when he's all like, just because in the book Danny doesn't know,
yeah,
you know, they have to tell him, but in the movie, or the movie, he knows. And the way that Jack Nicholson reacts to that is just so funny to me. Like, Jack is like, he kills me, man. He's great. So here's you may not know now, but if you were to think about it, potentially forward thinking, next time you read it, how do you think you're going to visualize the characters? And how did you visualize them before, I guess? Is it the movie, or do you have kind of your own images of them?
I had my own images.
Oh, okay.
Danny is definitely going to be always the boy from the movie.
Yeah.
I can't not get rid of Red Rum.
Yeah.
Red Rum with the finger and everything. I can't get rid of that.
Yeah.
Wendy is probably going to be closer to the miniseries than the book.
Okay.
I mean, to the movie. And same with Jack. I forgot to ask you. I was going to ask you this when we were talking about the miniseries. What did you think of Dick from the miniseries?
I liked him. I mean, he's not as good as Crothers, but yeah. he did good. I liked him. What about Commissioner Gordon as the other guy? The other...
Oh, yeah.
What,
yeah.
I'm blanking on his name. Bill something, right?
Yeah, the janitor, the caretaker during the regular season.
Yeah, like the grounds
keeper.
Yeah, whatever.
It's caretaker,
but
I think
it's Commissioner
right.
Gordon.
Yeah.
From the original Batman movies.
Yeah.
Or not original, the 1990s Batman movies.
Freaking miniseries Ullman, he has a part
Who is he?
He has a part in Friends, so that's where I knew him from.
Him from something, yeah. But I can't remember what it
bothered
was.
Me a little bit that he wasn't there on closing day because, you know, the whole Ullman, well, let me show you my hotel that I'm so damn proud of.
Yeah. They definitely changed that up a little bit. I'm trying to remember who he was, but I remember just being like, oh, God, it's Elliot Gould. Okay, so, dude, here's the funny thing. The night before that, I watched that fucking god-awful, I mean, it's a great, but it's so uncomfortable, dinner scene from American History X, which is Elliot Gould is the guy that's there with that. Mm-hmm. So I had just watched that, and then like the next day is when I watched the series. So I was just like, it's him. It's the same guy. And then of course, MASH, he's Trapper John, back in the original MASH movie, which I actually watched, couple years, within the last couple years, because I was always a fan of the show, the movie, and also Contagion I watched for the first time. I mentioned that on the last episode. He's in that, yeah. So I've seen a lot of him recently. So yeah, when he popped up in The Shining, that was something else. So let's see. Another Twitter poll I had. Pick one. Don't go into room 237 or 217.
What do you mean?
Just which one of you? Which one you got? Which one? What, if it comes down to it, who's what is? I mean, I guess maybe people interpreted this differently. I more meant like, what is it to you? Which of the rooms is it? But I think some people.
It's 217.
Took it differently. So, because OG Chris said 237 contains nudity and causes awkwardness when watching it accompanied. And he says, in parentheses, it happened to me. OG 217 was wild on my mind while reading. No contest. So I think some people took it as like, which one would you rather not go into? Like, which one would you rather go into less? I don't know how. I kind of more just meant it like, okay, if it comes down to it, you've got 237 or 217, which one? So the 237 got 45% of the vote and 217 won with 55. So definitely have more of a book side in general. But for me, it's 237. You know, it was 237 for me for most of my life because it was the movie. But it's funny because I... like was always one of those things where I had to like think about it to say 217, yeah. But I've now come over the last couple of years, like it's 217. And there's times I have to stop and think like, wait, no, 237. Cause I'm talking to someone about the movie. Like, so 217 now is my default in my head, but for the longest time it was 237. So you get one trip. Where do you go? The Stanley or the Timberland? You're going to go spend a weekend.
Stanley.
Okay.
One, it's closer, but it's also where King got the inspiration from.
Yeah. I mean, so, the Timberland is, like, iconic for the outside.
For the outside, yeah.
And, I mean, and ultimately the Stanley, like, now with the miniseries, you can actually, you see it, right?
Yeah.
But, like, ultimately still, like, it's more of just the, for me, it's more of the nerdiness of, like, yeah, like.
That's where King stayed.
Yeah, that's this is where I got the ideas.
I wouldn't even need to stay in 217 to be thoroughly impressed.
I
know you will. but just impressed to see, like, the hotel itself and see the grounds.
Yeah.
I read in the trivia that they built a hedge maze there. And I'm like, you motherfuckers. I know why you did that.
Oh, they should get some topiaries.
They had them. They had them. They got rid of them for a hedge maze.
Okay. So, yeah, I just thought that was... I mean, ultimately, I'd love to stay at both. That'd be fun. But I was just like, if you had to pick between the two, that'd be a good question. So I kind of mentioned Kubrick picking Shelley Duvall because he said that's kind of... We already kind of talked about that.
Yeah.
So I guess... You disagree with that, is what you said, right? Okay. Okay. Just make sure I had that. Forgot I had that question.
I don't disagree with the casting of Shelley Duvall. I disagree with what
reasoning.
They did with the character of Wendy Torrance.
Yeah. So the last thing I've got here, and then we can wrap up the episode. If you're going to piece together elements from anything, from the film and the miniseries, how do you go about it? Overlook.
Overlook exterior... No, exterior and interior from the movie.
Okay, yeah.
That is iconic. That is so beautiful.
I even though as much as I love the Stanley in terms of like again because it's historical significance, like it's really the root of this entire novel.
It's such a boring building.
But like to me, it's not even that. It's just a matter of like that's not the Overlook. Like, that's cool. Maybe a haunted hotel.
No, it's
just
boring.
It's not
ominous.
Yeah, it's
like Danny's supposed to like get fear struck into him when he looks at it. Sorry, that building ain't going to do it to anybody.
Yeah.
I don't care what you think you're going to see. That building is a white building that is just boring.
Yeah, yeah. So I agree. I'm going to go overlook for the movie as well, for my overlook. What about Jack?
I got to go with Steven. If we include the character arc.
Yeah, yeah.
If we're including the descent into madness, the struggle with alcoholism and everything like that, I got to go with Steven. If we're going for one that's going to scare the piss out of someone, Nicholson.
Yeah. Yeah. And you know what's funny is the one thing that dawned on me when I was rewatching the series, and it was a huge revelation, maybe the biggest like takeaway for me for the whole thing, is I've never thought about it, but whether you're talking about Dr. Sleep or whether you're talking about The Shining, when I'm reading it and I get to that, because in the Doctor Sleep, don't we get a flashback of kind of the end with the boiler and stuff? There's like some flashback to it. Both of those moments and in The Shining when it actually happens, I've never realized it until rewatching this. I've always pictured Steven Weber.
Really? For that.
I pictured Jack through most of the book.
Hmm.
But there's certain elements in that, specifically with the boiler and fighting the demon, basically, to fight back and come back as Jack. I've never pictured Jack Nicholson.
It's because
I've always pictured Weber, man.
Yeah.
And I've never, it's one of those weird things, like, it's been in my head every time I've read the book, but I've never thought about it consciously that, like, holy shit. Like, the whole time I'm picturing Shelley Duvall, I'm picturing the cast from the movie.
Yeah.
But then when it gets down, well, in some cases, like, Ullman, completely different in my head. Like, for me, it's, like, kind of, like, the bald, Weasley, whatever, like, little, like, think Weasley version of the fucking bad guy from Indiana Jones with the coat hanger thing. Think of, like, a Weasley version of him. That's almost what I picture for Ullman. He's just, like, this fucking, in, like, a pretentious suit. Like, it would just be a guy you just want to punch. Like, just, like, the most deplorable. Like, that's what I picture for him.
Yeah.
Like, but, like, yeah, that's, when it comes to Jack, I would probably go with Weber as well. But, yeah, it was a huge revelation for me on that. Wendy?
That's a coin toss for me. I mean, they're both there. I got my problems with Wendy in the movie's character decisions, like what they did with that. And I wasn't thoroughly impressed with the miniseries character. Not the character, but the actress herself. I'll go with Shelley Duvall.
Okay. Yeah, I think I probably would stick with Shelley Duvall as well, just because, like, I don't know, like, even though, yeah, it's more true to the book, but I still feel like Shelley pulls something off that, I don't know, like, that's...
It deserves to be respected.
Yeah, that's Wendy. Like, I feel like that is it. Even though King's writing it differently, it's one of those things that Kubrick overrides him in a way. Like, that Shelley's, like, in my mind so much as Wendy that there's not a single time that I can't think of her in that role.
Mm-hmm.
So, yeah, I'd go her. What about Danny?
I had to go... That's the toughest one, I think.
Yeah.
I mean, the Jack one is easy because of the character differences, but these two were both pretty good.
Yeah.
I like the miniseries kid. I like Danny. I got to go movie, though.
Yeah. For me, it's tough to not go with the movie with Danny Lloyd.
Yeah, Danny Lloyd.
Yeah, I would too. There's just something about it. That's all I picture when it comes to... when it comes to Danny is that actor. So, but no, the kid in the new one, he did it, or in the miniseries, I guess it is the newer of the two, but yeah, he did do well. But I just think that, I liked Danny Lloyd better in the movie. And then last on my list is Dick.
I like the Dick in the miniseries, but dude, I mean, like you said, that Dick in the
Scatman Crothers, yeah. Man, he's just the best.
He's like, so cool.
Except that he gets fucked over by Kubrick. But yes, I would definitely go Scatman Crothers and hope that he actually gets his, you know, rescue and helps, you know, in some way other than getting an axe to the fucking chest. Yes, so that's what it'd be for me. I mean, I guess it would just be the movie except for switching out Jack.
Yeah.
That'd be the main for me. I don't know. It's hard to overcome that. I mean,
it's so iconic.
I would even say that, like, okay, we talked earlier about the Shawshank. Shawshank is probably a better movie in terms of if I was ranking it, but iconic, Shining is more iconic than the Shawshank.
Oh yeah.
I would honestly wonder, is there any of King's that are more iconic? Pennywise, I think, is the biggest argument. But God, dude.
Pennywise would take it. A killer clown.
Now, does it take away from it now that we have two versions of that?
No.
Whereas, like, people think, like, Shining, like, all they think about is Jack Nicholson and Shelley Duvall. Like, they when they picture it, it's the Kubrick movie. Like, that's just this iconic thing. I mean, like, I think of, like, okay, we got a Simpsons episode. Like, I think of, like, even something like Twister. It's on the fucking drive-in screen when that tornado comes in. Like, it's just one of those things that's so iconic. It's ripped off all the time, spoofed all the time. It's just so iconic that I just don't know. I think that
I'm just thinking about a scene in the spoof now. Homer busts through the door. Here's Daddy. Don't.
Yeah. No. Yeah. Yeah. And then he goes to the other one and says, I can't remember what he says.
Yeah.
It's another intro for a news person. And he's like, hi, my name's Grandpa. Oh yeah, that's great. So yeah, that's our I guess. Do you have any other closing thoughts or anything that you wanted to bring up? I just kind of
we never came back around to this. I was holding off because I thought you were going to ask what I want to remake now.
Oh yeah, yeah. I actually did mean to put that on my list. I forgot
because I was going to bring that up, and you knew where I was going. You're like, hold on, and I'm like, okay.
Yeah,
but I would absolutely now, especially after seeing the miniseries and rereading the book, I absolutely 100% agree with your argument that Jack Nicholson and Stanley Kubrick's Shining and Shelley Duvall's Shining. I'm going to throw the three of them in there because I don't want it just to be Stanley.
Yeah,
those two put so much into that movie that they deserve credit just as much as him. That Shining is always going to exist. It's always going to be there. It's going to be iconic.
Absolutely.
It's going to be on my list of great movies.
Yeah.
That if someone says, hey, name a great horror movie that I should watch to scare people. Great. Watch The Shining. Make sure to watch it in the dead of winter when you feel a little bit isolated.
Yeah. Or if someone's like, hey, give me a horror movie that's not your average, dark, jumping out of fucking like jump scares and stuff like The Shining. Like because I was talking to somebody about it like not long ago with the movie Midsommar. Where it's like, I told someone, I feel like, to me, it feels like The Shining, because I don't know if you've seen it, but like Midsommar is like so atypical because it's like almost the entire thing's in daylight and it's not really as like bra scary type whatever, but it's more like fucking unsettling, troubling, like just like The fucking Shining. And I'm like, and when I started thought about Midsommar, I was like, holy shit, it's like The Shining. And then it really dawned on me, I'm like, yeah, I guess it is true. The Shining is like one of the most atypical horror movies. It is nothing like most horror movies.
There's not very many moments.
Yeah, no, it's mostly just like horrible fucking tension and just.
And I think that The Shining redone today, make it modern even. I think it would be.
I don't know about that. I was thinking about that.
I was thinking about that one day.
I'm like, I don't know if you could do. Because then you got like satellite phones, you got cell phones, there's like different things you'd have connection to the outside.
That doesn't make it any easier to not break those items. I mean, you're talking about a family that's in poverty almost.
Yeah.
Okay. They're not going to be able to afford it. Is the hotel going to provide it? No. Remember, Ullman's a cheapskate. There.
Yeah.
Boom. Solved it.
Yeah. I don't know, man. I debated on that. I was in the car. I think it was, I don't remember if it was when I just listened to the end or whatever, but I started thinking like, cause like, yes, my answer is I do still want a remake. I've been, kind of pounding the drum for that for a couple years now. In fact, I was saying it in a lead in to Dr. Sleep. I would love to see a new adaptation of it.
Yes, you did.
And I don't see it as a remake. I see it as a readaptation. Like, yes, it's funny because there's certain movies that we just accept like once a generation that we're going to make.
Yes.
You know, like A Star Is Born. Scarface is becoming a new one now. You know, there's a new version of Scarface they want to do. Well, cool. There was one in the 30s. There was one in the 80s. Like, just every so often you do it. King Kong. Why is it that, like, some are accepted, but then, like, some it's just like, oh, my God, how dare you fucking, like, shit on the grave of this other movie by doing it again? Like, it's not that.
Yeah.
And I actually pitched this on Twitter as just kind of a thing on our Twitter handle where I was like, how about, like, a new version of The Shining? And whether it's a miniseries or whether it's a movie, but how about almost exclusively focus it on Danny? Like in the same way of like Child's Play. Cause like, think about it now with his psychic ability. Imagine if it's a miniseries actually having like a chunk of the first episode before any of it happens. And it's like him like dealing with like his parents thinking about divorce.
Yeah.
You know, like there's like some stuff there that's like, you can get into a lot of like really cool shit if it was just like primarily focused through Danny, because it's like, could you get away with it? Think about most of the story. Could you get away with almost all of it through Danny's perspective and not having Jack and Wendy's? Like, there's some stuff where it's like, yeah, debating on like, oh, like, should we take like whatever, but like, is there anything that you couldn't just have him privy to through his powers? Yeah, like, so there's just part of me that I said that, there's a few people who are like, I've never thought about that. Okay, yeah, now I'm down. Like, but yes, I still want a new version, man. I think that, because I think the source material deserves it. Not that the miniseries didn't do a good job capturing that. Not that the Kubrick movie's not one of the greatest movies ever made. But
it's been 40 years since the movie. Like, why can we not get a retelling of this story? Like you said, we have ones that are generational. I mean, it happens.
Now, here's the one caveat I'll throw out. Dr. Sleep has changed my mind a tiny bit. Because now Flanagan has kind of merged them all together. So
I think that,
I think
if there wasn't Dr. Sleep, we absolutely would be primed for a Shining remake.
Yeah.
Retelling.
Yeah.
As you used to put it. But I think with Dr. Sleep, I think you're right. I think that kind of puts
puts a bow on it, where it's like, I mean, even King's now like kind of reconciled to like the Kubrick film through what Flanagan did. So it's like, there is now maybe doubt. Like, rather than saying like I'm 100%, I want a new version, I dial it back and say I'm 75%, I want a new version.
Yeah, because that would just discredit Dr. Sleep as well. I get you.
Yeah. So Jack's in the chat.
Yeah, Jack joined us. He says, I love the way the Shining movie uses the music, or lack thereof, to add to the tension.
Yeah, like, there's times there's just no music. There's other times, like, the music comes in and it's so fucking nuts tension that it's
jarring.
Like, holy shit, dude. Like, the scene with the him, you know, like, staring off, like, doesn't have a really sharp violin, you know? Jack, that's the other thing I was thinking too. Dreamcasting, who would you like to direct the new Shining?
Well, Flanagan.
I mean, the thing is with Flanagan, though, now it brings into question with what he did with Dr. Sleep, would you really want to put him in that position to now have to, like, because he already went up to that line of, like, I've got to make a sequel to the Kubrick movie with King on my other shoulder that doesn't like the Kubrick movie, and he fucking nailed it. So, like, maybe it's one of those ones you give it to someone else because, like, cool, okay, like, he bowed it all together where it's like, cool, Kubrick's movie,
okay,
my movie, King's all fixed. Now
let's,
somebody can come in.
Let's go see the movie we were supposed to see. Let's go give it to Frank Darabont. Because King talked about it. It was supposed to go to Frank, but it's like, nah. Nah.
Yeah, well, I mean, famously, that's Dark Tower.
No, yeah, Dark Tower, that's the one I'm thinking of. I'm mixing up the two there.
Yeah, Dark Tower.
No, let's give it to Frank anyway.
Yeah, and Frank hasn't done a whole lot recently, ever since he left The Walking Dead. I think he's been in some legal troubles there. Or, like, not he's in trouble, but he's been fighting legally for some, like, money from The Walking Dead. But, yeah, I think that, I'm trying to think. Honestly, there's part of me that, like, would honestly love to see, I'm blanking on his name now, but the guy that did Midsommar and, God, I'm blanking on the name of his other movie now. The one that I fucking love, Hereditary. I think that just with the batshit way that he fucking does his movies, I think that I'd love to see him do it.
Ari Aster.
Ari Aster, yeah. I think Ari Aster might be my dream pick for a director, man.
Okay.
Because watching Midsommar, like, that's a dude, like, I mean, there's like shit in there where it's like, you know, like, airbrush some pretty heinous shit like into the trees at one point, or it's like, I'm not airbrush, it's probably CG, but like, you know, like, I just feel like shit like that, it's like, that's the kind of stuff that shows that he could probably do the Shining. Also, the fact that Midsommar is a movie that almost primarily takes place during the day,
and it's a horror film,
like, that I think I would roll the dice on him and I'd say, like, let's, I mean, of course, yeah, there's the King royalty for sure, that, you know, in terms of like the Stephen King royalty, like Frank Darabont, now I would say that
Flanagan's
in there, man. I think Flanagan's in that royal procession now. But no, I think that just for like the crazy nature of it, I'd love to see.
Let's hold off Dreamcasting for The Shining, though.
Yeah.
I got to be perfectly honest here with you guys. I have not thought about that, and I want to give it some thought.
Yeah. Yeah, we can. Yeah. And he says Dreamcasting, who would you like to direct the new Shining?
I know that that's like the next natural question. Okay, well, who would you have play Jack? Who would you have play Wendy? I want to hold off on those because want to give it some
thought. Sammy J got to be
the
Dick Halloran?
Halloran?
Doesn't it have to be?
No, it doesn't.
I mean,
I can think of one.
He's King. He's in King's Pantheon already. And that just seems to me like the badass older black guy that's driving some fucking badass Cadillac, like, that just feels like Sammy J.
You want to know who I would?
Just
you don't know
like
who
it,
I would
man.
Prefer over him? I'd take Don Cheadle.
Yeah, is he old enough?
Dude, did you see him in Endgame? He's like covered in gray hair. And besides, technology is wonderful when it comes to aging people.
Oh man,
Don Cheadle could make a really good Dick Halloran. No more.
I just feel like Sammy J is like
keep expecting him to drop that. How do these motherfucking ghosts to this motherfucking hotel?
No, it's not that. But like, I could just like, I just imagine like if you're especially doing like a series and it's on streaming and you could go like full language, like, you know, like he's at the airport and stuff. Motherfucker, I need to get on that plane. Like, you know, like just. Because I feel like Dick kind of had that cool edge to him and stuff. You know what I mean? Like, I'm not just saying it like because it's like whatever. I'm saying it because like I feel like Dick kind of has that cool nature to him. Like, he's driving that badass car. He's kind of just like this, like, yeah, I'm a badass motherfucker. Like, you know, yeah. I'm like whatever. I don't know. But yeah, I guess Sammy J has already done the haunted hotel thing with King before. So, yeah, we'll think about Dreamcasting for a future little side tangent of a normal roundtable. We can.
Well, we do that Dreamcasting thing, so we could easily do a Shining version of that. Instead of doing an actor, we could do, okay, let's do the four main for...
Yeah.
For...
Yeah. I think if we did it as a whole side tangent thing, because I'll make up a list.
Okay.
Because, I mean, you got the main people there, but, I mean, I still think, like, Ullman, I think there's some fun that you could have sometimes with some of those, like, smaller roles that you could throw, like, a character actor in. But, yeah, I don't know. We'll definitely do that in the future. I thought about it for this, but I figured with what we had, it would be a long enough episode that would just go crazy. And which, yeah, it's about right. We're getting close to 3 hours, so we've ran long.
Just
so yeah,
a little bit.
Yeah, so we'll go ahead and wrap up. This is a very unique episode. I mean, I've done Unfound Doors before, but it was alone on, you know, just me on my own. It was kind of a sideshow that we were like separate from everything. But we just decided that like the Unfound Door, since we're doing the more of the King universe now than we were when I launched the Unfound Door series, figured it'd be kind of something that we could bring in and do both of us and, explore something. And it was just kind of fun to go through and do everything with this. So we'll be back to Dark Tower next time with a book club, as a matter of fact.
Right.
So, and we actually think that this will be our penultimate episode for, the Drawing of the Three.
Mm-hmm.
The way it's breaking out, I do believe that we're going to not finish it. I don't think we'll finish it next episode, but I think that we'll get to where we've got only one episode after that. So here,
and the nice thing is,
which
that
means
if
the Wastelands is coming up,
yeah,
very soon.
And the nice thing is that if we finish Drawing of the Three and we still have a little of extra time, that doesn't mean that the episode's going to finish early. I mean, there could be a general discussion about the book overall.
Yeah, that's exactly what I planned, because because I feel like the way it breaks out, I don't know that we'll have a full episode with what's left, but I do want to kind of have like a recap, thinking about everything, whatever. Yeah, kind of a closing type thing. But yeah, so let's go ahead and hit the outro stuff. If you want to subscribe to us, you can do it on Apple Podcasting, or you can stream us on Stitcher or Spotify. You can find the show notes at darktowerpalaver.com. On there you can also find the new questions for new listeners. If you're a new listener, answer those and email those in if you'd like. The email bag is getting mighty light, so if you want to email and not wait a number of months to get read, this is a good time to do it. Peter can tell you the best way to do that, as well as engage with us on the social medias.
Best way to reach us, like Ted said, emails. We're looking forward to some new emails coming in. It's darktowerpalaver@gmail.com. We stream our shows. It's youtube.com/darktowerpalaver. Make sure to like and subscribe. Ring the bell to get notifications for when we go live. And then our social media is facebook.com/darktowerpalaver. And then Twitter, it's @darktowerpod. That's @darktowerpod. And Instagram is darktowerpalaver. All one word.
Yes, indeed. So join us next time as we hit our... second to last episode of Drawing of the Three book club. Really excited for that. We're getting to the nitty gritty now, so join us then here in a couple weeks, and we'll sign off as we always do, as by saying long days and pleasant nights.
Long days and pleasant nights, folks.
All right, thank you guys in the chat. Dolly, let's see, Jack, we had a
ZT.
We may have had others. The numbers were a little bit different at times, but if others were just in listening, that's fine too. Thank you guys. Always fun to have you guys in the chat, engaging in conversation, and I don't know, good input all the time.
Always.
So yeah, enjoy it, and we will see you guys in a couple weeks.
Bye, guys.